Something on the mic, though. Oh, there. That's what I sound like when I'm complaining. I don't hear myself in the mic. Do you hear yourself?
No, I don't hear myself.
This is. Oh, there it is. Yeah. Okay. I'm complaining.
How's that level?
So I guess it's fine. I can't complain. I can do it. I can do a little more.
A little more juice?
I wouldn't mind.
Are you two? Is he two? You're two, man.
Sure.
I'm three, though.
But this one's loud, too.
Well, that's for Elijah.
Okay, right.
You get that reference? You're pretty goy. You ever been to a
pastor? I'm assuming Elijah is God.
Incorrect.
There is a guy here named Elijah?
Mm-mm.
Oh. Mm. Well, clue me in.
I love that we're... This feels fun already.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, I just think you're great. I really...
Pete, I love you.
Right off the bat.
There we go.
I always love seeing you, though. That's true.
Yeah, it's never and, not fun.
It's never not funny with Jimmy Pardo.
Yeah, also a podcast I've not listened to.
Oh, that's what you were saying. What I was about to say was we're sipping our 7-Eleven coffee.
Yeah,
brought to you
by
7-Eleven.
It's pretty good too.
It's not bad. I go with the 100% Colombian.
Okay,
I think it's the funniest one. 100%, like it's insisting. Like I'm pure.
Yeah,
I'm pure Colombian.
Yeah,
French vanilla. It's not 100% French.
No,
100% Colombian. Not every bit goes somewhere.
No,
whose?
That was me.
Yours.
It's my first rodeo. No, turning it off.
There has to have been a moment where a cowboy at a rodeo was like, this is my first. There it is. Stay on the road a bit and you'll find bits. What do you were wondering what you need to know about this show. I'm wondering what I would have said off mic about that. I don't know. It's one of those soul-bearing shows.
Is that right?
How do you feel about that?
Let's do it. I'm ready to bear
myself. There's been a couple people that didn't want to do it. Jack McBrayer.
He didn't want to bare his soul?
Not really.
That's funny,
he's kind of a private person.
I only assume him to be very earnest and
well, I just
because
wanna,
he plays in
I want to talk about everything.
Yeah.
I can't really do it.
Yeah. I just want to share about the watering hole.
I can't do it. But I
can't
see
do it.
Him.
I'm not even going
to
try.
I want you to kind of try.
No, you're on your own with that one. You're out on a limb.
Don't leave me on a limb.
No.
You're an ensemble player. This is why Timmy Williams hates your balls.
He hates a lot of things about me.
Does he?
We butt heads.
Do you really?
Yeah, sure. Well, yeah.
Isn't that weird?
Well, here's the thing.
I guessed him of all the people.
Oh, but you know what? Everyone butts heads with everybody.
Okay. So, yeah. Well, so we should say you're in the...
I'm in the Whitest Kids You Know.
The wonderful, wonderful Whitest Kids You Know. You know what's funny about... Let's talk about this. It's called You Made It Weird. We're supposed to say things... You know, we don't have to do anything, but what I'm about to do is make it weird. The premise is I wouldn't normally say what I'm about to say.
Oh, wow.
Like in life. Because you're supposed to avoid it.
Oh,
it's
this
not,
is good.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah, 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 yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah, yeah. But I can do it back to you.
Of course.
Oh, great. Okay.
And the premise, the premise of the show, it's like a safe treehouse. We can say whatever we want.
Sure.
But it's never supposed to be like uncomfortable.
But people will listen to it in mass.
People do listen to it in Catholic mass.
Okay.
This is what I would say. I watched the premiere of Whitest Kids, you know.
All right.
This is what I'm telling you. That's weird. And then I was like... It's hard for performers to take out their jealousy and stuff.
Right.
Because I remember you got that show, and now it's sounding like Maren's podcast, but you got that show at a time when I was like, I want a show. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
And I was watching it, and I remember we got to the Sam Brown pooping in the hot balloon.
Sure.
And I remember being like, that's dumb. Now.
And you were right.
No. I agree that was dumb. Part of the show is doing and celebrating dumb things, though.
There's no doubt about that.
It's like, here's the conclusion, because I like there to be healing.
All
that's
right.
The wound. The wound was me going, that's dumb. And I was actually watching it in Sleepy Hollow, incredibly depressed. I was just about to get divorced. So I wasn't really in the mood to...
You weren't in a laughy place.
I was.
But here's the thing. I will say this. I will say that, I mean...
Let's talk about dumb.
I cringe when I watch our show.
Do you?
Oh, my God. Yeah. There are so many sketches that I regret putting on television because here's the thing.
But you have a lot of volume.
We didn't have any writers. We never had any writers.
I know. Well, that brings me to the second part, which was I was thrilled later, years later, season...
You wrote the... One sketch that anyone besides us ever wrote that made it onto the air. There was that same year that we asked you for submissions, we asked this other girl for, I don't even remember her name, which is terrible.
Oh boy.
And she submitted a sketch that we liked the premise and we rewrote that. But those were two sketches out of around 500.
Yes.
And we didn't want to ask anybody. Like they insisted we have writers in season 3 and we asked John Gimberling and Curtis Gwynn.
Good calls.
We were like, guys, don't write anything, just take the paycheck.
Really?
Yeah, and they took the paycheck.
Are you kidding me?
Yeah, we're like, just take the paycheck, we have to do this, but we don't want anything.
Oh!
That's how, weird we were. Now, looking back, I wish we'd gone the Human Giant route and just gotten the best people around to just be submitting, we would have been such a better show.
Curtis Gwynn are like two amazing.
They're great sketch writers. They're amazing sketch writers. I don't know what, we had this weird thing where we were like, we've always done it this way.
Yeah.
We don't want to dilute our
flavor. Well, you're like Radiohead. Radiohead don't want to like record their albums outside of wherever they live. It's not London. They live in like Oxford or something.
Yeah.
I don't know where they live.
Although they have recorded albums in LA.
Is that true?
And big OK Computers and
I knew Darian?
Darren. I call him Daronius, but yeah, sure. It's just stupid. Okay, keep going.
Oh my God. He's the one that I always forget, which is not, I'm not saying he's forgettable. He's actually super hilarious, but I always call him Darian or Darius Ruckus. Mm. Okay. I call him Hootie.
All right.
No, none of that is real.
I didn't think so.
Always get his name wrong. Yeah. What was I about to tell you?
I have no idea.
Oh, you were saying that so I wrote sketches. This is what I had to do. So I had to watch your show. And I watched a bunch of it to get ready to, like, submit you guys' ideas. And I think it's one of those, like, it's not like I had a thing against you. It's just I watched one episode and Sam Brown is pooping out of a hot air balloon.
And you know what? This
and then
is
I was
my,
like, fuck that.
And this is my problem. This is why I still have an inferiority complex around all comedians that I respect. Because there's so much on our show that's so bad, like that case. When that sketch, you know, whatever, there's worse than that, believe me. And I'm embarrassed because we've put out such poor material. I'm also very proud of certain moments of our show.
Sure,
I think that's like, you know, one out of five, I think, is like, I will put my stamp on that.
Yeah.
I think it's good.
Kind of like a funeral
yeah.
reel.
Two out of five, I'm like, eh, there's moments. And then, you know, two out of five, I'm like, oh, God.
Yeah.
Like, I hope no one ever sees
that. Well, I got to tell you, if you're watching Whitest Kids on YouTube, which is what I was doing,
uh-huh.
it's only the best ones. And I was like, these guys are incredible.
Well, hey, but that's changing because we've never uploaded anything to YouTube ever. It's just like
you can't.
Fans that
right.
have uploaded it. And yeah, we're not allowed to.
Right,
obviously, and they keep getting their channels shut down. So we've had videos that have had like, you know, nearing 20 million hits,
right.
and they're just gone because somebody has a problem with
right, right.
flag. And it's really disheartening because that's the only like scale of merit that I have. Like it's
right.
like, well, that at least got that many YouTube hits. Somebody
right.
must like it. And then when that's gone,
yeah.
there's like this like very empty feeling I get when I'm like, oh,
they have to
like
start
someone
over.
Just stole your trophy. And
I was
going
to say it's a trophy,
it's like, but that video was, you know, people
right.
like it. It got more than 12,000 hits.
Didn't you have, forgive me if I'm wrong, but didn't you have the slap video and then that was made into a Super Bowl commercial?
There's a big controversy.
I'm sure you've talked
yeah.
about that.
No,
before.
I haven't.
Oh, really?
I don't
okay.
do podcasts.
Oh, God. Well, thanks
no,
for
No, I really
don't.
Like, this is probably my first.
We're yoga
like,
buddies.
Yeah, we're yoga bros.
yoga bros. This is your first kind of sit down. It's weird because you live in LA and there's so many of us.
I'm just not. It's just not. I don't.
You know, Chelsea might start one. She said she might start one.
I'm sure it'll be great.
And then you're gonna do that one.
I doubt Chelsea would ask me.
Why?
I don't know.
You and Chelsea are friends.
We're very good friends.
I know. And that was one of those weird things where Chelsea and I are very good friends. And then we go on night walks.
Mm-hmm.
And then sometimes we'd meet you for a night walk. And do you remember this moment at the end of the walk? You just casually hugged her, and I went, "You hug your
oh,
other
man.
Friends."
Well, you know what? I feel like I'm so awkward with hugs and goodbyes anyways. That was probably all on me because sometimes if I'm like,
it felt
when
so
in doubt,
natural.
Just go for the hug. You know, just do it. You know, it's going in for a hug is not going to get you in nearly as much trouble as like the awkward bye.
Yeah.
Just
waving.
Eat the hug.
I also thought it was incredibly badass that you smoked on the walk. We're like walking uphill.
Oh, Jesus. I gotta stop.
I know. I always feel like because it's so faux pas in Los Angeles that
I know.
Feel like that's like such a weird thing.
I know.
Whereas like, 20 years ago, it'd be like, we were on a walk with Chelsea. We were smoking, of course.
Like, yeah.
We were outdoors. Why wouldn't we be smoking?
It's such a drag.
It didn't a drag of a cigarette?
Yeah.
Okay, all
Ooh,
right.
Oh, Peach. Oh.
Hit the hee-haw. It just turned into morning radio.
Yeah.
Where were we going? We were talking about volume. We were talking about YouTube views and the Super Bowl slap.
Oh, yeah. So that basically was, you know, right before our show came out, we'd had a demo that we were doing, and there's a video where we're all slapping each other. And
like it's the new hello.
Uh-huh. And then there was a Super Bowl commercial for Bud Light that had a very similar thing. I was never convinced that they ripped us off, but
like
other people were.
Yeah.
And I was always like on the fence. I was like,
like,
I mean,
Timmy
it's a
Williams.
Little similar. Yeah, some people. I'm like, that son of a bitch. But here's what's interesting. Bud Light had approached us to submit commercial ideas to them. Our agency had sent them a DVD with that sketch on it.
No.
And enough time for them to do that video. So I will also say that after we raised the stink, they pulled that commercial from the air
Really?
And I've heard, and I don't know if this is true or not, that certain people were, you know, in serious trouble. So all of those things make me think, like, you know, there could definitely be something to it.
I feel like Timmy Williams might be right in that.
Timmy might be right. But, you know, the jury's out. And as somebody brought up to me recently, Sam from the group was like, you know, when we made that big stink, there were actors that must have been so stoked to be on a Super Bowl commercial.
Yeah.
And then we threw up a fuss, maybe legitimately, maybe not.
Well.
The commercial got pulled, and that is serious bank that we cut.
That happened, you know, I do the E-Trade things, and one of the spots, the Lindsay Lohan debacle. Mm-hmm. Now, I had no involvement in that or anything, but I do know that we had to stop running the commercial. I think there was a cease and desist put on the spot. So the actress who played my girlfriend in the spot that says Lindsay, like, lost a lot of money.
A lot of money.
Like, a shit ton. I don't know if it's a shit ton of money, but...
Dude, those were huge national ads. I'm sure it was. And think about that with the Super Bowl going on.
Right.
I mean, those ads go for a long time.
At least, I think ours aired at the Super Bowl and then stopped. I don't know. I know that she lost money because who knows why that all went down. But, I mean, it sounds to me like...
We're never going to know. Ultimately, it wasn't even a bad thing for us because you know a lot of local people were talking about it. You know, like the apiary. Which at the time, I remember there's a time where I was like, if the apiary mentions me, it's a huge, incredible thing.
The apiary was a comedy blog out of New York.
Right, very small.
That was one of the biggest things. I used to check the apiary every
morning. I used to check it every day.
Every day.
Every day.
Refresh some photo.
I would check the apiary and be like, how many people will I have met on this website? Like, that was a big deal. Oh my God!
Can I tell you I have never talked about this. This is my favorite prank. Remember the apiary had? I'm not a big prank person, but I should reconsider that position because I was just walking around thinking about how happy this made me. So the apiary, this blog that all the comedians in New York and a lot of show business people in New York would check, had a thing called the Honey Shot. Do you remember the Honey Shot?
Yes, I do.
Apiary is a beat, so they have Honey Shot. So it would always be like, you know, you and Sam at a Whitest Kids show, at pianos or something, some candid shot. And it would just say, you know, Sam Brown and Zach Cregger at pianos. And it was a Honey Shot. That's it. That's the setup. So, but it would always say, like, photo submitted by Jackie Novak or something. You know what I mean?
It was always Jackie Novak.
Couldn't stop with the photos, like, Jackie.
Give it up.
I love Jackie. Do you love Jackie?
I actually don't. I don't really. Oh, you don't really know. I mean, we've met a couple times, but I don't
really know her. She's wonderful. I want to have her on the show. So I thought it would be really funny. Me and Joe Mandy both decided that would be really funny to submit.
Now, Joe is very prank heavy.
He's very pranky.
Joe is a very pranky guy.
Every time I have an idea for a fake Twitter account or like a prank,
he's already done it.
I know. I give it to Joe. I go, how do I make a fake Twitter so it can't get traced back to me? He's like, you know, Jason Bourne. I need help.
Yeah.
So I was like, I have this idea for a prank. I want to put a photo of John Mulaney and, like, something embarrassing, and have it say photo submitted by John Mulaney. Like, so it would look like he submitted his own photo. And Joe emailed me back this photo of John and Dimitri Martin, who at the time, you know, he's still big, but was, like, much bigger than John, much bigger than all of us. Yeah. So it would look braggy.
Yeah.
And
That's great.
We made it obviously cropped, like he had cropped other people out of it. And it was up for weeks before I called him, and I was like, hey, you seen the apiary lately? And he's like, why? And then he went and he looked down, he scrolled down, and he's like,
Oh no!
And someone hit him in the face with a pie, and it was all black and white for some reason. It's kind of the only prank I've ever done. And I'm very proud of it.
Yeah, you're not that kind of guy.
Are you a prank person?
The Whitest Kids are vicious with each other. Vicious with each other. In fact, I'll tell one that.
Please.
And Sam, you're gonna get mad at me, but it's too good of a story, so I'm going to tell it.
Yeah, please.
Sam, and he is gonna get so mad at me. I'm gonna eat shit for this, but I'm gonna tell. And also, I will say this: like, I think he's still bitter about this prank, but I think he has legitimate grief. Chelsea tells me that we are assholes for doing this.
Oh boy.
You know. So here's what happened. And Sam, I'm going to try and tell this in as factual of a way as I can. We were writing together in LA for like one of our seasons. I don't know which one. And I don't know which. We got so goddamn many, Pete. Am I right? I mean, come on. Who can keep track? Five. We got five of them.
I thought you had more.
Well, let's let them. Maybe we do. I don't even know. All right. So. Sam has a sweet tooth, and that's not, there's no shame in that, but what Darren would do for entertainment,
Darionius,
would buy a bag of candy, open it, just leave it on the table, and just get a kick out of watching Sam without asking permission, just eat the candy, the whole bag over the course of a writing meeting. And like, he would like kind of nudge me and be like, he's eating it. Which is like, okay, that's not, you know, that's not bad. It was just kind of like a dick thing to
do. Yeah.
It was like, you know, Sam doesn't ask permission to eat the candy. So it was like, that was the joke. So Trevor and Darren one day go to the store and they buy this giant bag of chocolates and they buy a giant bag of chocolate laxatives. And the laxatives, each one breaks into three, and each one is three separate doses. You're supposed to break the chocolate into thirds and eat a third. They unwrapped each laxative and each chocolate and swapped the individual wrappers of each individual candy, put it back in the bag, and left it open on the table, and watched as Sam, throughout the course of one writing meeting, ate, like, it had to be like 60 doses of full grown-up laxative. And and what's crazy about it is no one knew. Darren and Trevor were the only ones that knew, and they kept it cool. I was oblivious.
He's three, I'd be, you're going poop.
Yeah. He ate tons.
60.
Yeah. And, you know, obviously it had repercussions with his system.
When?
Immediately, I believe. I'm not really sure the timeline. But the next evening, we were all very, very drunk, it came out, like, we dosed you with laxatives, and he was, you know, I guess now in retrospect, justifiably outraged, but it was a huge blow up fight.
Did he tell you what happened?
One thing, and here's what he's going to get really mad at me. The one thing I remember laughing at was Sam at the peak of his indignation being like, I borrowed your car to go to Del Taco, and I had to fart in the car, but I didn't want to do that because I am a friend and I wouldn't do that. It was like, first of all, you did fart in the car. Whenever you're alone in a car and you have to fart, you do. Secondly, if your body is going crazy, why are you in the drive-thru at Del Taco?
He wants to see how far he could take it. He's like, I feel like I'm in trouble.
Shoot the moon, buddy. Shoot the moon. Sam, I love you. You're right to be mad. It was an asshole move to do. He wasn't out of line. And, you know, a lot of people having heard that story, like, well, fuck you guys. Right. Sam was right. And
it's not like vengeance. Like, people like a good prank involves vengeance.
Right.
Like, mine is pretty mild, but Mulaney didn't, like, have it coming. And Sam didn't have it coming.
He did not have it coming.
Either. It was nobody's like, you got that guy that loves candy? Yeah. Good. Yeah. But he also didn't shit his pants.
He did not shit his
pants.
If he did, no one's ever going to know. He's taking it to the grave.
I mean, like, that's pretty brilliant.
60 doses of adult.
There's no way he didn't shit his pants.
In the course of 2 hours.
And he's on his way to Del Taco farting. He shit his pants. He filled up his pants. There's no way.
Maybe that's why he's so mad about that incident.
Of course.
Yeah, could be.
That's a weird...
This is your hypothesis.
Yep,
I am not going to...
No, I'll go out on the line. Sam, right. I'm saying you definitely were taller by the time you got to Del Taco.
Oh, when am I going to get the fucking rage phone call from this?
You know what's funny is I was just thinking...
I'm not painting him in a bad light.
No,
right?
You're not.
I'm really
you're doing
not,
great.
Right?
You're okay. doing great. And right. you know what? You can listen to the podcast before we release it, but I think you did a great job.
Okay.
I really do. A couple things. It's funny. I was just thinking about this today. There was this kid. I went to this weird repressed college, and there were these kids.
Gordon, where my brother went.
That's right.
Yes.
That was on my list of research, which I never open unless we hit a wall. But your brother goes
my
to
brother,
Gordon.
My brother, he just recently graduated.
Yeah. Oh, shit.
And Ring by Spring is rearing its ugly head. Look, I'm not saying he's going to get engaged, but he is very hot and heavy with the woman that he was dating there. And they're living. They've moved to Charlottesville, Virginia together. They're not living in the same roof because Gordon kids.
Because I was just going to say, that's what I did, but I got married because I was like, we're not going to get two places. So you get married.
Yeah.
That's insane.
You know, look, I'm not going to...
He's going to get married.
I can't judge his relationship. Maybe
I will.
Maybe it's perfect. She's a wonderful girl. I've met her plenty of times. I like her very much. But at 22,
Don't do it, little Craig. I love calling you Kriegs, even though I know your name's not Cregger, but I love calling you Kriegs. We'll get into Gordon. I'm going to write down Gordon. I'm going to tell you two things.
We got a lot of things to cover, Pete.
We're on pranks, and then we're going to get into your brother.
Okay.
Okay. So the first thing is at Gordon, there was this, it wasn't really a prank. It's not a prank at all. It's illegal and against the law. But
it's a crime.
Somebody pulled a crime. There was this kid.
Crimed you. That's what muggers say. You just got crimed.
That's why you stopped chasing him. You're like, it's kind of delightful. Yeah. I kind of enjoyed that mugging. So there was this guy, and you know, homosexuality was very poo-pooed, frowned upon at Gordon. So we had a lot of closeted gay people, and I thought about it. I was like, I forget what the statistic is, 1 out of 7 or something. I don't know.
Of Gordon students or
of
people?
Of just people. So gay people. So I was like, I bet there were a bunch of gay people. And I knew there were some gay people. And some of them are gay now, you know, out.
They're out.
I know them now and I see them now. And it actually does my heart really well to be like, oh my God, we all knew you were like really in a bad place at Gordon and you couldn't come out. But unfortunately, there was this one kid who set up a video camera to tape his roommates, right? And I remember one of his roommates was kind of like, that's fucked up. And the other roommate, like, really lost his mind. You know what I mean? Like, really was, like, felt really bad about it. And I was like, what is, like...
Videotaping them doing what?
Oh, changing and stuff. Like,
that's terrible. Camera.
What I'm telling you is a terrible thing.
Well, isn't that guy in jail for doing that to that kid?
Great
who
question.
Committed suicide?
It's one of those things.
Very famous.
You know, like when you when something happens, like in a high class family, and a crime is committed, like a cousin sex or something, right. They'll just sweep it away. They won't press charges. I feel like that's kind of what my college did.
Well, the victim obviously didn't commit suicide. So
the victim didn't commit. Oh, that happened. Someone got videotaped and committed suicide?
This was giant national news.
I'm trying to remember. This was a huge news story.
Yeah, I think it was Rutgers or somewhere. Some asshole filmed his gay roommate making
having
out with
sex.
A man.
I remember, and then he killed himself.
And then the guy, yeah.
Okay, see, that's kind of what I'm talking about. So he had videotape of these guys changing, and then one of them was like, that. Like I remember he was like, that's kind of messed up. And the other one like took it much harder, and I remember being like, when people react to pranks, like you're saying you were gauging someone's reaction to a prank kind of, I'm losing my train of thought here, it implies something about them. Like, why are you flipping out so much? Yeah. Clearly you shit your pants. That's why you flipped out so bad. So one of these kids was flipping out, and I was like, what did you do? You know what I mean? That was like the, I know this is bad.
Because he wouldn't be mad if he came home and was like doing homework.
That's exactly
and, like,
right. And being naked, drying off. I was like, you're spread eagle jerking off onto your own face or something. You know what I mean? That's when you got really mad about that. The second thing I was, and that is a sad topic, and I don't mean to make light of something so tragic. And you're right. They should have, there should have been police.
Well, I don't know. I think we're too quick in this culture to, you know, get police involved.
You think that was a good... Maybe they decided because he was a friend not to press charges.
You know, obviously, I think that kid, you know, you could also say he probably got his just desserts by losing those friends and his reputation. People
and
are
also,
still talking about it. That's consequences.
Yep, and also being booted from the school.
There you go.
I'm pretty sure.
All right, do we need to...
Do we need to?
I don't know. Maybe I don't know. I think maybe that's up to the victims.
I'm pretty sure. And now that guy, from what I can tell, is now happily out and not videotaping people, but having like standard gay sex.
Okay,
like regular gay sex.
Gotcha.
Not hidden camera sex.
So the gay guy was the one doing the filming.
Yes.
In the story. I don't know if that really changed the story in any way.
Well, presumably he's gay. He wants to see his roommate taken.
That. Oh, it wasn't like a shame joke thing. It was a peeping Tom.
Oh, no, it was like
we transitioned from pranks
yeah,
into the
I'm
story.
Sorry.
I thought
I'm
that's
sorry.
Where we were going.
No.
Gotcha.
It was like, I'm going to watch this and have a good time.
Oh.
Watching you, my friend.
Well, then he should be in jail. The police should have been involved immediately. And
really? Oh.
No. Throw away the key.
Here's the other prank I was going to tell you. Which is, I just depressed myself telling that story. Here's the other one. So I'm like 15 or so, and me and my best friend, Ern, did the same thing with laxative chocolates. It's like X-Lax made laxative chocolates just to be
it's
like...
It's not the most clever of pranks. It's just
not.
More the sheer audacity of the amount that these guys
that's
gave
That's impressive.
Him. 60 adult doses in 2 hours is that's
and this, like, can
borderline
I tell you,
psychedelic.
This is why... Yes.
Yes.
He was tripping.
Yeah.
I want to tell you why I think Sam definitely should have
said okey-dokey.
With my story. With my story here. So... we bought some X-Lax chocolate made probably exclusively for pranks. I feel like that's a product made for... They should sell it in, like, joke and magic shops. It shouldn't be in CVS. Like, why? Who is like, I need to shit, but it better be delicious.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Take a pill. So we bought some, and we scrub off the word X-Lax on the chocolate. You know, like, we cut it off or whatever. And we gave it to his sister, Kate. And she ate, like, 2 pieces of it. So that was 4 doses. And then, like, the next day, us two giggling knuckleheads are like, anything happen? She's like, no, why? She just, like, had, like, a satisfying bowel movement.
Yeah.
She was like, no, I just had, like, a great morning. She's, like, 8. You know what I mean? And then But we got in big trouble, and I remember our teacher was like, some people are allergic to laxatives, and you could have killed somebody, or whatever, some bullshit.
That's what Chelsea said.
Really?
That's what Chelsea said. She said, you could have done serious injury to him. And first of all, I didn't do this prank.
Yep, that's
true. I just laughed at it.
Yep.
But I don't think that you can with a laxative. I'm just guessing here, but I feel like a laxative has diminishing returns after you take 5 doses.
Your body goes, we get what's happening.
Yeah, I'm clearing it out.
Yeah.
You're still telling me to clear it out. I'm still clearing it out.
Isn't that what people do when they need to, like, get drugs out of their system, which Sam probably did? that guy is a joint.
Drugs.
He is a joint.
Oh, my goodness.
Every time. I always picture him just with a hefty bag of weed on an oriental rug and just rolling it up and be like, that's my morning joint. He went crazy with weed. He loves weed. I know this isn't okay to talk about because he's not here to defend himself, but I've gotten contact
Sam
eyes.
He would not deny that he loves weed.
No, he loves it. Yeah. He loves it big time. So yeah. Anyway, So to prove that it wasn't a big deal, my friend Earn. See, I like to do for you what my friend Earn listens to the show, and he will be upset that I told the story. So here we go.
Okay, here we go.
Same boat.
All right.
We're
holding hands and jumping off the cliff together.
That's right, okay. Thelma. Here we go. So he eats a laxative chocolate. Be like, what's the big deal? Who cares?
Immediately shat his pants before he finished the sentence.
It was coming anyway. It was like Pavlovian. Pavlodian? Okay. So he eats the chocolate. And then, so we're in junior high, which is just an awkward time anyway. And later that day, he was waiting for the
Are you going to be able to tell the story?
He was waiting for the bus. You have to picture my friend Earn, thick glasses, red head, like an afro sort of thing, and just waiting for the bus. And he just fills his underwear. He makes a shit hammock, okay? Because he's wearing tighty whities, because that's what you do.
Yeah.
So he just makes a shit hammock and walks back to school, you know, does the zombie trot, like he's on an invisible horse, and gets back to school. And, like, all the girls we liked, we were in a very small
school. Back to school. Back where the humiliation is.
Well, he couldn't get on the bus with extra.
You walk home. And on the way home, you find a bush and you take your underwear off. And you keep walking home.
I feel like that's a different. That's when you're doing it to, like, some bullies from a different school. They're like, hey, shit hammock. And then they stab you. He goes back to where the. The school should have been emptied, but there was, like, some quilt making class some shit. So all the girls are still there, and he shuffled by all the girls that we had crutches on and unpacked his special delivery.
Of course, all the girls you have crutches on are there. Doing something as pure and innocent as, like, knitting, and you have shit all over
you. Oh, we love the way they knit. I went to a weird school where there were only, like, 6 girls in our class and, like, 7-6 boys.
That was about the same.
Is that right?
Yeah, my graduating class had, like, 36 kids.
Really?
Yeah.
What kind? Why? Mine was,
it was a private school in
where?
D.C., DuPont Circle.
Did you like it?
I did like it very much. It was like in 2 old buildings across the street from each other, and we would have class in the bedrooms. It was very, very interesting.
Oh, like old, not old school buildings, like old...
Old residential buildings.
Creepy.
That they turned into a school, yeah.
Oh, I'd love to see that. I can tell I'm getting older because, like, I have an appreciation for, like,
old, that sounds
that
interesting.
Sort of
oh.
I'm like, I'd love to see the molding. Yeah. That's how I know
I'm
older.
We had, like, bathtubs in our bathrooms.
Freestanding?
Yeah, with, like, clawfoots and everything. It was very weird.
I love a good freestanding tub. That's how I know I'm 33. Every once in a while, I'll think, am I still 16? I'll go, look at that mirror. You know what I mean? No. I really love it. When I was a kid, I was so bored. My parents took me to, like, the Rockefeller Mansion. Like, mansions that looked like the end of There Will Be Blood.
Sure.
And I was like, fuck this.
Yeah.
Hated it. And now if you and I had a day off and I was like,
we should
go
to Hearst Castle just fucking come all over ourselves.
I would love it.
We will go crazy.
I would.
I've been actually. It's pretty amazing.
Really?
You'd love it.
That's where they did the There Will Be Blood, right?
No, actually, I don't think you're allowed to film there. That's where the William Randolph Hearst, he's the character that they based Citizen Kane off of.
Okay.
He's the newspaper baron from way back in the day, and he basically had this incredible house built from things he'd shipped over from old Europe. He collected ceilings from, like, you know, the 11th century.
Really?
He was, like, that level of rich. And he built this just preposterous structure up on this cliff looking over the ocean,
God.
And it is truly
I want to go
spectacular.
Have you ever been? I doubt it. It's called House on the Rock.
I've not.
It's in, I believe it's in Katie, can you look it up? I don't want to. Because
have you heard of the Widow of Winchester House? Do you know about this?
No. What is this?
This is
what is all right, it? This is two men in their 30s.
No, listen to this.
Genuinely
enthused
about architecture.
This is a crazy story. So the woman, the widow of the guy who invented the Winchester rifle way back in the day, who became a billionaire,
yes,
or the equivalent at the time, he died.
He had a 50.
He died. She went to a psychic, and the psychic told her that the ghost of everyone who has died from a Winchester rifle was going to haunt her, and the only way she could thwart being haunted was to continually add construction,
yes,
to her home.
I've seen this
so
on the Discovery
has,
Channel.
Her home, her whole life was constantly being added to. There's stairways, yeah, that go to nowhere.
Yeah.
There's closets inside of closets inside,
yes,
of closets. And I've never been, but it's supposed to be labyrinthine and truly
I would
profound.
Love to go there.
I would too. I think it's in like San Jose, so I don't know how far
San
away it is.
San Jose. It's in Wisconsin?
The House on the Rock.
House on the Rock, one of the best things I've ever done with my life.
Oh.
I went there. Okay, can I please tell you this?
Yes,
this
please.
Stupid story? Then we'll go back to small schools and how that felt and everything. I was on the road, and again, I had just gotten divorced. And I did like 50 colleges right after I got divorced. So I just went on the road and like just stayed out on the road, which was perfect. I was like, it cloaked my grief. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Nobody really got to see me during that time. But I did get to like ride alone in cars and stuff. And I had a day off in between two schools, and I was just driving all over the Midwest. And this girl that I was seeing at the time was like, you got to go to this thing called House on the Rock. And I was like, I'm not going to go to the House on the Rock.
I feel like
stupid.
I've heard of this. Okay, keep going.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And, but I had a day off. This is something – can I tell you something weird about my personality? I'm just like – I'm like – sometimes I'm too simple. Like I can't be bothered. I have a day off, and all I really want to do is get to the hotel and watch a movie and go to bed. You know what I mean?
I totally identify with that.
Do you get that?
Yeah, dude. And that's not even an age thing. Like I could have done that when I was 15.
Me too.
Yeah.
Summer vacation, I was like, barbecue, more like barba snooze, and then just stay home. And that's why
video... And you'd say that until someone either laughed or was like, Pete, we heard you. We heard you say
did anyone hear barba snooze?
More like barba snooze, right, everyone?
I go to the barbecue
just... You just say it again and again until they're like, shut up, Pete, we heard the joke, it wasn't funny.
But if I keep doing it, it will be, I insist, little Letterman style. So you relate to that. I don't know what it is with being comedians and, like, being okay with that sort of lifestyle. Mm-hmm. There's something very cozy and, like, if I have a day with nothing, that doesn't panic me. I don't have enough of that type A. Chelsea sometimes gets that type A where she's like, I have 500 things I have to do. You know what I mean? And she'll have a productive day.
But I can't do them because I'm tweeting so much.
She'll suck it, Peretti!
Yeah, sing, Chelsea.
But she can be productive in a day. I'll have a day with nothing and she can also do nothing. I can feel her getting mad at me. Anyway, we can both do nothing. Let's just keep it on me. I love doing nothing, and I'm driving on the highway through Wisconsin, and I keep seeing signs for House on the Rock. And I was like, all right, universe, uh-huh, I'll go to House on the Rock. And I pulled off, and I just thought it would be like an antique house. And
is that all it takes, just billboards?
Yeah, basically.
So you stopped at like every McDonald's.
That's all I need.
You see 10
every
billboards
Panera.
For the same thing, and you're going in. All right, sorry.
It's kind of true. So I go, and it is the best place on earth. I'll say that. It's not. It's like this kind of like Asian style. It almost looks like a Japanese house. But it's just this eclectic guy who built this huge house on a rock, presumably. And he just kept extending it and extending it and extending it and just filling it with, like, the coolest stuff. Like, antiques you would like. You know what I mean? Like, creepy old toys. Like, these machines that play violins behind glass. Like, robot violin players. And it's dark and it's labyrinthian, to use your word. And I went in and was the only person there because it was, like, you know, a Tuesday. And I went in and just spent, like, 4 hours alone in this house. Never
alone?
Yeah, I was
no tour. Just
no
hey,
tour.
Man, go nuts.
Go in. The woman who sold the tickets was asleep. I'm telling you a story of one of the best days of my life. I went in and there was this old Midwestern woman that was not asleep when I came up to the ticket booth. It was like a movie. It's like a Tim Burton movie.
Wow.
The place should have become real and I should still be there. And I bought a ticket and then I went in and every like sixth room there would be a sleeping old woman in it. It just seemed like part of the attraction.
No, really. Really?
Yeah, yeah, because it's their job to be there and no one's there, so they're all
so
just
they're going to stop you from stealing.
Basically.
That's the worst security.
I know.
Ever. A sleeping
know.
Elderly woman.
And they didn't even wake up. I was like a ninja. They'd have rooms that just like filled with 500 airplanes, like different kinds of airplanes. There's a carousel with like thousands of different horses and scary ones. And you go through this. There's a room that just has a huge whale in it. It's incredible. Okay, that's me doing it alone.
That's amazing.
Okay, so now I was like, I can't tell if I'm right that's amazing.
No, that is.
Cut to, thank you for your faith. I'm with you. Cut to me, Amy Schumer, and Kumail, and I think that's every, and Marianne, our friend, the tour manager. We're on the road, and we were driving through Wisconsin, and I was like, oh, my God. The House on the Rock. And we didn't have time. Marianne was like, we don't have time. I was like, you don't understand. Like, as evangelical about it I'm being to you, I'm being even more so in this tour bus.
Well, because it's a possibility.
I'm like, we have to go. Yeah. And we got out like children and ran, because I had sold it so much. We ran like little babies. You know how kids dance and spin for no reason? That's what we did. And Marianne was like, we only have 15 minutes. And we were like, fuck you. And we went in, and we just like lost her and had like the best time.
And they agree.
All three of us agree that it's like the happiest place on earth. I think Amy's been back since. Flew to Wisconsin just to go.
Is it near the Dells? By any chance?
I'm very bad at spatial intelligence, so I'm not sure.
All right, doesn't matter.
But I would love to go.
Well, I would love to go.
I just sold the House on the Rock.
That was impressive.
There's a room that it's called the Infinity Room that just looks like it goes on forever, as the name would suggest. And it's, you know, it's of course an optical illusion. At a certain point, it's just a model.
Oh, tapers.
It looks like Spike Jonze's house. You know what I mean? Like if you could just imagine what his house would look like in his dreams. It's so fun. And and I think kids would like it, but adults especially, you get that sort of like, oh, it's not every day that you see. They had like this old antique toy called Death of a Drunkard, and you put a coin in it, and it's like a real antique toy, and it says wino.
I've seen this.
You've seen Death of a Drunkard?
I've seen Death of a Drunkard because there's a thing in San Francisco on the wharf where they have this like old kind of arcade where it's stuff from like the teens.
You've seen?
And you put coins in, and like grisly little you know, models come out on tracks and kill each other and then go back behind a thing.
I can't believe you've seen that.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah, there's a lot of cool stuff up there.
So you can imagine, I think the best way to go was in a deep depression and alone on the road and putting a coin in Death of a Drunkard and just watching a wino die in an antique toy. He literally like sits up in the bed, drinks wine, and then like a weird door opens and like presumably like a death demon sneaks out and he sees it and dies. And you're like, this is fucked, but also amazing.
And what if that's what happens to people who die of alcoholism? Like they're karmically sentenced to like be, you know, possessing in that man, and they have to die again and again whenever some asshole puts a quarter in.
Please don't put the coin in. I don't want to see him.
It hurts. It really hurts.
Oh, Jesus. That's awesome. That's so, I'm so glad well, you know what's funny about that haunted place, the Winchester, what's it called? Winchester House?
Winchester Widow, I believe. Oh, it's called the Mystery House?
Yeah, they changed the name.
Mystery House?
That's not as cool. Yeah, I'm going to call it Winchester Widow.
Let's go to Winchester Widow.
Dude, that's not a bad idea at all.
Where is it?
I think it's a 2-hour drive.
No, it's near San Francisco. In San Jose.
I'm going to San Francisco.
I might go to San Francisco tomorrow. Are you kidding?
Shut up.
I'm serious. Dude,
I am.
I wrap it.
My flight is at 6.
I get out of work at 1:30. Got a new show, by the way. We should talk about it.
Yeah,
we don't want to talk about your show.
No.
Well, then I'm not talking about mine.
No, I want to talk about
it. I get out at 1:30 and I'm thinking about driving up.
Go. I'm there all weekend.
How are you getting up there?
I'm flying.
Oh, dick.
Because you're on a show.
How soon do you? Yeah, right. How soon do you have to buy your tickets? Because I always like make my mind up the day before.
I feel you can do a San Francisco flight day of. It's not like going to Europe where they're like $7 million.
Really?
You know what I mean? Yeah, I love
What's
those.
What's the damage usually?
I don't know. $100? $150?
That's totally doable.
Yeah.
Especially because, I mean, that's how much it costs with gas anyway.
Yeah. And also, you can get a first. I love the Seattle flights. I love San Francisco because you can get a first class ticket. It's like, do you want to upgrade to first class for 10 cents? You're like, yes, I do.
Right on.
I'd love to feel like a fancy fellow.
Maybe I'll do that.
Let's go while we're in San Francisco.
Well, here's the reason I would go to San Francisco is because like an old roommate of mine is visiting another old best friend of mine, so I'll go to hang out with them. So I would rather not see you there while
bring
I'm
them. This is like when I'm trying to get
maybe,
you to do yoga.
Maybe that's
and you're
not
like,
a bad idea.
I can. I got better things to do.
I'm always legitimately doing something that I can't get out.
I know.
We got to get back on that train, dude.
I know. I was doing really well. I was doing a lot of yoga. I just went and then I stopped because I was on the road for like 5 days.
Yeah.
I didn't go. And then I went back and I was like, fuck this. Like, you get bad at it immediately.
It is brutal.
It's like comedy. You have to do it all the time.
Yeah.
I think that's one of my interests in it, is that it's the sort of thing that you have to do all the time to remain good at it.
Right.
So stand up, And things like yoga or presumably racquetball. I'm saying presumably a lot. Or golf. These lifelong pursuits sure. always interest me. Those unmasterable things add longevity to your interest.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's like, I'll be doing that forever.
Yeah.
Comedy, of course. And then maybe things like yoga, puzzle making.
Puzzle making?
Yeah. Making my own puzzle.
Right on.
I just cut up pictures I drew. Yeah, it's never as good as a store-bought puzzle.
But you do. You have picked a trade, and you have honed it, you know, with dedication for a long period of time. So don't. I mean, you have no room to beat yourself up on this. I feel like I have.
About
jack
what?
Of all trades, master of none, sort of a thing. It's like,
don't we all feel that way?
Do we? I don't know.
You don't feel like a master of sketch comedy? I mean, you guys.
Not. One bit.
That's why you're good.
I don't know.
We need to feel like we're not very good.
That's also like the one I have like the least sort of interest in.
Sketch?
Yeah, honestly. I mean, I love doing it, but it's certainly not like my passion.
What's your passion?
I don't know. I have so many. That's the problem.
You're like Jennifer
Aniston. I tend to kind of just like go with the easiest thing. Like I've been very fortunate with acting, so I'm just like, oh, okay. And then I feel validated, so I don't feel like I need to like apply myself to other things that I really enjoy doing, like music or art or things
like
that.
Isn't that funny?
And I sell myself short. It's a drag.
I think we all do. And I think successful people and interesting people, sometimes part of it, I think, is that they luck out at being good at something interesting and also easy. You know what I mean? I don't know too many people of like, when I did stand-up, I was garbage. Most of the successful stand-ups I know, they were like, yeah, I wasn't terrible right away. Uh-huh. I was bad.
And I got immediate, self-esteem boost.
Yep.
So why wouldn't you?
Liked it. You know what I mean? Like, even though it was painful or difficult, I think you're talking about something that's pretty real. So you feel scattered in your interests?
Very much so.
Yeah. Music is one of them?
Huge.
Really?
Huge, always been. Lately I've been painting like crazy. Like,
really?
I'm crazy about it. Yeah, totally.
I went through a weird painting phase. What kind?
What kind of painting?
Like, are we landscaping? Are we?
No. Should we talk about this? I feel like no one's going to care about this.
Nope. Guess so many people just turn this up.
Yeah, right. What is he painting? I got to know what he's painting.
No. I think it's interesting when artists are doing other types of art, and I'm wondering if it satiates you in the same way that comedy does. I'm wondering.
It satiates me in a more and more because,
more?
First of all.
See? That's
no
interesting.
No one is there to tell me if it's good or bad. I do, like, my music and my painting, like, I don't show people. I don't play my music for people.
And you're
I don't
talking show... to a brother right now. That's
and,
what I do.
Right? And because I don't want anyone to tell me, like, it's good in a tone that I don't believe.
Yeah.
And I don't want anyone to tell me it's bad.
Yeah.
In my mind, it's incredible.
Yeah.
And it's going to stay incredible as long as no one shatters that illusion.
I think,
I'm, like, very precious
about
it.
Isn't that the... I think maybe I said this on the show before, but when I was in college, there was a musician that I really liked, another guitar player. He got kicked out for filming his roommates. I'm kidding. Not the same guy.
Gotcha.
He loved playing... Wow, that was zero. You
I gave
me.
You nothing on
you
that one,
Pete.
You
gave me zero. You took laughs out of the room.
No, because honestly,
no,
I was thinking about what I was going to say, and I was listening to my head and not listening
man.
To your mouth.
We're brothers.
All right.
But I told him that I wrote songs, which I did, and I never played them for anybody, and I thought that was a failure, and he was like, no, I think that's the perfect place to get to where you don't need to show it to anybody.
Yeah.
That's how I feel.
Here's what I want
about guitar.
I want to be found dead in my apartment. Like, I want John Kennedy Tool. One day I want to be dead and have people comb through my things and be like, he was a genius painter. His music was amazing.
Katie, are you hearing this?
Like John Kennedy Tool, the guy who won the Pulitzer Prize for writing Confederacy of Dunces, because after he died, his mother found his manuscript, mailed it to a publisher, and now it's like a huge, it's one of the funniest books ever written.
Zach, you just said something that I've said on the show.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. I mean, verbatim.
Really?
When I paint, I'm like, I don't need to show this to anybody, but when I die...
I hope somebody appreciates it and puts it in the Louvre. And,
yeah, crazy.
Yeah, crazy, right?
That's crazy. Yeah. I mean, that's exactly what I've said.
Really? Dude, we are brothers.
I know, it's really bizarre. I'm really having a very... I'm glad it's recorded. It's kind of giving me like a Winchester Widow vibe. I'm kind of freaked out. No, I love it. So you're looking for the thing that clicks into you perfectly, but it's not sketch. Sketch is your
and
success.
And you know what? It's always changing, too. Like... It'll change.
But isn't that the
but
formula
it always,
for...
It always changes around the same, like, four things, but yeah.
Where are you now?
Painting is my thing.
See,
right
that's
now.
The thing. I was painting for a while, and I was painting all the time, and I was like, this is my zen, and I'm really enjoying it. And I haven't touched a brush in months. And I've only been doing, you know, stand-up.
Right.
And then stand-up will always be there. And then music, I won't play my guitar for a very long time,
dude,
then that comes back.
I went crazy last year and spent about, like, $1,500 at a go, and like, which is not very much, but like for me, I was like, "Well, here I go."
You mean
on like a little home recording studio and like a giant, amazing keyboard? Maybe it's closer to like $2,500, something like that. I don't know why I'm bragging. I'm not bragging about how much money I spent. It's just to show like I'll go like through a phase where I'll be like all in, And I would like record like crazy for months. And now I moved, and I don't feel like making music in my new apartment because the walls are too thin. And I'm self-conscious.
Yeah.
I haven't touched that crazy keyboard.
This is something else that comes up on the show, and I wonder what this says about comedians. I'm trying to put us in the same group, creative people. I don't know, but like even with yoga, I've said when I'm into something, I'm incredibly into it. It's like falling in love.
Sure.
There's something about, do you fall in love quickly?
No.
Interesting.
No.
Did you when you were not?
You know, I fell in love over time with a girlfriend that I dated for like 6.5 years. I bet you met her once, Caitlin.
I bet I did too.
And when that ended, I fell in love immediately with another girl who I'm sure you met. I'm not going to talk about. But
wait, what is that?
That
mean?
Was
let's
like
because
it's just I'm just not going to. But I fell in love with her overnight, and it was you know ended
badly.
Soon. Not badly. I still talk to her. We're still friendly, but it just like it was. You know, I talk about this with Moshe Kasher all the time about like the value of the emotion of falling in love versus. You know, love can mean so many different things, and it's a long, hard slog, really, if you want it to last for a long time. And it's a decision, you know? And I don't think a lot of people acknowledge that love is a decision.
Yeah, it sounds so shitty when you put it that way.
You can follow that tingly feeling all you want, but it doesn't mean it's the right thing. Like, when the girl that I was with forever, you know, that was work. And I never really had that, like, I'm walking on sunshine thing ever. Like, I definitely had it after years went by when we were, like, deeply in love and committed. It was incredible.
Yeah.
But in the beginning, you know, not so much.
Sex is better, too, right?
As time goes by?
No, I mean, like, when you're deeply in love and stuff, I bet it's really nice.
That is such a multifaceted question.
Really?
An answer that I couldn't begin to...
Really? No.
Oh, my God. Because there's different factors at work. You know, you've been with someone for a long time, so sex means more.
Yeah.
There's more trust. But then again, you've been having sex with the same person for, you know, so long that it's hard to find surprises. And
yeah.
So, I mean, yes and no.
Eating at the same Arby's.
I would never refer to her as an Arby's. She's an Outback Steakhouse if she's anything.
Bloomin' onion again. Oh, God.
No, she's a wonderful one.
No, I get that. I get that absolutely. I'm just, so are you saying, I know what you're saying. I don't need you to clarify it. I think you said it well. And then the other girl you fell in love with more deeply and quickly?
Well, more quickly and more emotionally. And dude, there was nothing wrong with her either. It's just, you know, I thought we were going to be, like, I thought this was it. Like,
how
this
long?
Was the thing. And we lasted, like, a year. We broke up once or twice in the course of that year. And it just clearly wasn't. Once the butterflies kind of, you know.
Was it a too intense to fail sort of thing? Was it like, did you guys fight and break up because it was like.
We didn't fight. I'm not a fighter, really.
Neither. Did she yell at you?
No. She wasn't a fighter either. Just we realized it just wasn't it just wasn't right.
And then got back, though.
We tried it again and then realized again it wasn't right and then that was
how many times? Once?
Just twice. I think we tried it twice.
Twice.
Yeah.
That's interesting. But why were you breaking up?
With the first one or the second one?
Let's stay with the second one, I feel
was
like.
Why were we breaking up? For what I said, I think there were just moments where we're just like, we know how it's supposed to go. Like, we've both been in healthy long term relationships. Mm-hmm. We know how it's supposed to feel. It's not doing that.
Okay.
So let's
this is the downside of getting older. We love architecture, but we also like know what architecture of relationships is supposed to look like. Like, there shouldn't be a chimney in the bathroom. I think we need to break up.
Yeah.
Unless it's awesome. There could be a chimney.
This relationship is like the Winchester house. It's exciting. There's always something new around every corner, but it's also terrifying and creepy.
And some of these stairwells go nowhere.
Yeah.
So let's just end it. Well, that's interesting to me, man. The first one, why that?
I like that this is okay on this podcast. I like that there's not a pressure to be,
funny.
Boom, boom, boom.
No, we kind of start off bitty. There's no real format, but the bits.
But you don't care
away.
If we get into this. That's cool.
Oh no, that's the whole show.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I'm interested in the quality of your heart in that you fall in love quickly with your endeavors, music,
mm-hmm.
painting.
Okay.
Do you see a similarity to? That one of those girls was like guitar, and then all of a sudden it's like fuck fish.
I have never thought about it that way.
That is adaptation.
I don't think so. I think they're very different.
Because, are you sure? Because
I'm not sure.
Okay, because I'm not sure either. We're figuring this out together. I don't have an agenda here. But when I realize, like, I'm like, yoga. Here, okay, let me change it.
Sure.
Let me put this to you. when things are going well for me, like all my shit's taken care of, all my boxes are checked and life is good and I'm just feeling complete and powerful, that's when I tend to like get in relationships. I'm like, come on board. There's room for you on my like success ship.
That's healthy. That's good.
You think that's good?
Yeah. Because it's better than being like down and out, broken and looking, come on, I need someone to pull me out of this ditch.
Yeah.
Know? That's bad.
I feel like it's dangerous though because I feel like I can get along with anybody when all my needs are being met. I've said that before.
I understand what you're saying.
I'm like, I'm a pretty good person if all my needs are being met. And then if you hang out with that guy, he's great. But then, like, who am I when the chips are down? You know what I mean?
Interesting.
Shouldn't I get in a relationship when I don't know when to get in a relationship, Zach. I have no idea what to do. When do you pull the trigger? And it fucks me up. I've only been in, like, 4, 5. I don't know. Very few.
If you said more than that, I wouldn't trust you at all. That's not few. That means, like, I think you can have just as much insight if you've only been in one. Because
yeah.
Because it's all about the quality, you know what
yeah.
I mean?
Yeah. So. I hate, though, let me put this to you, and I'm sorry this is an uncomfortable question that I have to wrestle with, is the idea that, like, once you date, like, a girl that is, like, really your sense of humor.
Sure.
You'll always kind of compare other people to that.
That is what I am dealing with.
Yeah, right?
Big time. The bar
crazy?
Is high. The
high
bar
bars!
High. And I,
high
know,
bars!
And, you know, you can never go below the bar on two levels. You can never go physically below your bar. And
Zach,
you can never go personality-wise below your bar.
What are we
bar.
Doing?
Well,
how do we do this?
The good news is, and what I always say to myself when I'm tossing and turning is, you only need one. I only need one.
One
know?
What?
One, I just need one. I need to find one person that's going to fit this thing.
Yeah.
There's got to be one out there. There has to be.
I'm an optimist. I'm an internal optimist,
yeah.
too. And I think that will happen as well.
Right.
But it's like flying first class to San Francisco,
You can
perhaps.
Never go back.
You can't go back.
And I
Those
do all
people.
The time. I go back all,
I
like,
go back
I
all the
I'm
time,
I'm a bitter
too.
Son of a bitch.
I hate it, too. It yeah. kills me. It's because of that Virgin trick that I learned, that you can upgrade 6 hours before. Have you ever done that?
I have not, but I don't fly Virgin.
Gotta fly Virgin.
Oh, it's great. When I do, I love it. But
it's
the best. I've got the American thing going.
Physically, you go, oh, yes, I hear they have a good...
they don't, but that's what everybody...
United, they say, has a good one. But also, United cancels all these
Let's
flights.
Not talk about that.
We could.
I know we could. We could talk about anything.
It's all green lights,
We could
man.
Talk about fucking Toe
we
Jam.
We could wherever we want. Yeah. Toe Jam and Earl, one of my favorite games. The first one, the second one, no good.
Okay.
Sega Genesis. The physical one is tricky. I worry.
But that one you can get over because, like, everyone's going to look like shit in 30 years. We're all going to look like shit. So,
yeah.
you know, I could get over that.
Yeah, you got to get one of those.
Because you don't want to marry some smoking hot babe that annoys you.
Yeah.
And in 30 years, you're
have
married
you ever,
to somebody dumpy looking that annoys you.
Have you ever done that?
Have
you
God,
ever compromised
sure.
your values to be with somebody that
yeah,
you thought
was
really
hot? Yeah, and it lasted very short. It lasted for, you know, weeks.
Really?
Yeah. I've done it a couple times since I moved to LA, and it's lasted
so what do
practically
you,
no time.
What are you saying you're dealing with now? Is it the humor one that you have a hard time with? It's hard
if you
have a girl that makes you laugh like really hard.
Right.
That becomes then you start thinking like in 30 years when our bodies look like shit, we'll still be doing that
Dude,
bit.
That's a big deal. I'll tell you, some girl that can make you laugh really hard, that is a huge plus.
Yeah.
It's a huge plus.
Effortlessly too. I mean like, oh God, I just felt girls going like, "Oh, I should be funny." And then I'm like, "Effortlessly." And they're like, "Oh." not to get with me, just to get with guys in general.
Right,
like
right.
that's a hard thing.
Yeah.
But I think one thing that I'm learning about relationships is you just like just be yourself from the beginning. I hope I'm learning
right.
that. But it's so hard. I feel like I put on such a facade. I put my best foot forward. People say put your best foot forward, right?
Mm-hmm.
And like I've been doing that almost professionally for
yeah.
like my entire life. So like people see the polish and then eventually it starts to decay and I start looking less and less good and then they learn like, oh, whatever bad thing it is about me and then they don't like me anymore. And I hear about these people like Chelsea is one of those people who's like, this is me, like it or leave it sort of thing right from the beginning.
Yeah.
But like I feel like I'm selling myself sometimes at the beginning of relationships and then I get tired of that and resent them for making me do that even though they never asked me to do that.
That's deep.
It's a little deep.
I wonder if there's also on top of that a layer of... No, I think you nailed it.
Yeah. It's tricky.
Yeah, that is tricky.
So you're not in a relationship now?
No, not one. You know, I've been on a couple dates lately, but, you know, I'm coming off of a crazy, crazy weird year of... which I don't really actually care to get into, but I'm just like complicated. Let's just say it's been complicated.
In which way? Just the variety.
Romantically.
Romantically.
I'm talking strictly romantically. But,
wait, was one of these the two that we're talking about recent?
No, not one of
there's
those.
There's been another
three.
One.
There's another one. There was like a, I'll just say, there's a girl that I kind of very casually dated in the past who got very ill. and after we'd broken up. And through her illness, we've become way closer than ever before. But then it's like kind of she lives on the other side of the country, and you know, being there, like actually developing like real love, not necessarily like the love that, you know, would
not necessarily romantic
for the romantic thing, but like really. But you know, it's been crazy, and it's now, you know, I think it's kind of becoming more defined, which is nice for everybody. And I'm
more
know,
defined as a like, non-relationship.
Like, okay, you know, you're not moving to LA anytime.
Right.
I'm certainly not going to be back there. So we're going to keep this. We're chill. We're good.
Yeah.
And it's been good, but it's been a challenge.
You're touching on something huge. I'd like to share something, and then maybe we'll share more about that. Is that like one of my best friends in college who videotaped his roommate snake? I'm just kidding. One of my best friends in college, a young man, and he wouldn't mind me saying, I won't say his name or anything, but he had a stroke. And it was crazy. It was like exercise induced, at least that's my theory. I went down to be with him in the hospital, like Patch Adams style. I was like doing bits and stuff.
I'm sure you were, Pete.
More like Barba Snooze. I'm killing in here. Don't say that in the hospital. So I went down and spent time with him. And during that time, so here's a man that I love. Like he was my roommate all 4 years of college. I still call him my roommate. You know what I mean? I haven't seen him or talked to him in like 6 years, but I still call him my roommate. And I'm like, we go down and then everybody came down because we almost lost this friend. He's completely fine now. He's 100% now. You know, it's crazy. He totally rebounded. But like we all go down and we're with him. And then this girl that he loved dated pretty much all through college off and on. And then they broke up and then they were apart. And she was like, I never want to see him again. He has a stroke. Then what? She comes and visits. You know what I mean?
Sure.
Like she comes. And guess what? There's love in there. Probably what's happening in your situation. First of all, a stranger would love somebody that had a stroke. You would be like, oh my God. You know what I mean? You don't even have to know them. But if you have intimacy and a past, I imagine that would reinvigorate. And now they're married.
Wow, that's amazing.
And he, they weren't dating at the time. They weren't even talking at the time.
Wow.
And the stroke. And
perilous situations for people kind of are clarifying situations.
Yes.
Often, so.
Well, Emily and Kumail, whose picture are right behind you, and we talked about this on both their episodes, so this isn't a betrayal. Emily and Kumail, when they were dating, went into a coma for some time, and it was very, very scary.
Both of them together?
They went into a love coma. No. Emily went into a coma.
Like, if you love me, you'll take this pill.
It was very Romeo and Juliet.
Emily went into... I did not know that.
Yeah, Emily went... You should listen to her episode. I'm not just saying that. It's one of the best things that I've ever, like, been a part of. I don't even think it was, like, me. We just had, like, a great conversation, and we talk about it a lot. So she went into this coma, and I know... First of all, here's two things I know. I know that they love each other completely and they're perfect, and I think they're one of the best couples I've ever known or ever will know. And two, I know, because I don't want to cheapen the relationship at all, I know that that trauma probably accelerated things. That's my idea, is the introduction of mortality, the introduction of our fragility, that we all act like isn't a thing.
Right.
When really, Zach, us talking right now, I could have a stroke right now. You know, I could have an aneurysm right now. I could have a hole in my heart. 1 in 3 people do. So statistically, one of us
does. No, don't say that.
Yeah.
Is that true?
It's real. This is why my friend had a stroke. He has that hole in his heart.
Oh, God.
But everybody does. And it's okay. Most people don't have strokes. You could also get half a stroke doing yoga, I learned, thanks to Katie. There's certain handstands and stuff, headstands, that you do that some people have strokes. Very, 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 very few. And of those, very, 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 very few of those are fatal. So it's just like kind of like my friend's stroke, like a minor stroke. But like these things could happen. It's like telling a ghost story. I just changed the tone of this whole conversation. But what I'm interested in is when someone we love or loved, more interestingly, something happens to them. Are you allowed to say what happened?
Cancer.
Oh, cancer.
Yeah.
Is she well now?
She finished her chemo about 3 weeks ago, and she just had surgery on Monday where she had some lymph nodes removed.
Uh-huh.
And I think she is. It went great. She's cancer-free.
Really?
But, you know, you can be cancer-free. They say 5 years before you should really, you know, celebrate.
Interesting.
Yeah.
That's kind of like what they say about relationships. I've heard double the time and half the time. Like
I've heard that too, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like with cancer, you kind of have to wait. Don't celebrate quite yet.
But it was amazing. I mean, the chemo really worked great.
That's
and
great.
She's doing good. She's
That's
doing,
great.
Doing well. Superman does good. She's doing well.
Jesus does really well.
Yeah. He does well for himself.
Wait, really good. Wait, I don't know what she does. What was I just about to say? Oh, cancer. That's crazy. So that stirred up feelings, as it would with anybody. I think you'd be a monster if that didn't.
Well, you just realize how much certain people mean to you, right, and things like that.
Yeah. And then you visit, and then there's, I mean, like, I don't even know this person, and just in the story, I'm like, is she okay? You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
you can invest
that quickly. That's lovely, man. And that's kind of, and then, well, you decided that it was romantic, and now you're friends.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure there's always going to be, you know, something.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah, dude, totally.
Look at us. We're grown people.
Totally.
And we have these relationships that are complicated and not.
So complicated. Like, the girl I dated for, like, 7 years.
Yeah.
Honestly, like, if she were to call me today and be like, let's go, I would be like, okay,
fuck.
God damn it.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Right?
Actually, I was just in Hawaii, and she wrote me that she's pregnant. That was, like, the...
Are you
sledgehammer? I was in Hawaii with,
and you get a call that this girl that you,
an email from my ex who's like not married, and you know, it's, dude, it's just, I'm always gonna be like, I'll always love her forever.
Oh,
like,
Jesus.
It's like one of those things. Like, yeah. I'll always love her forever.
I'd die for
yeah,
you.
It's terrible, and I wish I could gouge that part of myself out because it's very painful. But
yeah.
She was like, well, we just want you to know I'm pregnant. It wasn't planned, but I am.
Is she still with the fella?
Yeah, sure.
They're together. They're gonna do that baby together.
They're doing that baby. such a drag.
That is a drag.
And that was the day of the wedding too. So I sat there at this wedding in Hawaii with
and
this,
weddings...
just like. Fuck me.
Oh, okay, so can
fuck
I...
Fuck my life.
Is it safe to say that the wedding alone would have made you think of this girl?
Probably, because every wedding does, but then...
Isn't that
just
weird?
Knowing, getting that news, like, hours ahead of time.
I'm going,
like,
to a wedding soon, and there's such a thing, like, for people that are in happy relationships, weddings, like, affirm them. And the rest of us, you can either celebrate and be like, oh, it's a wedding, let's get drunk and dance with strangers, and, like, people fuck a lot at weddings, I think. I've never had sex at a wedding.
So I'm told.
Really? I thought maybe you'd clean up.
I don't want to. I don't know.
Oh God, I love this show. I would listen to this.
It is
show.
Called. I just made it weird because I don't know. Like, I don't know what I can answer. I'm thinking like of all the people that could potentially listen.
No,
to
I know. I've been there.
This is why I don't do podcasts, honestly, because I feel like I'm a very. I don't ever know when to shut up, and I answer everything honestly.
Yeah.
And I don't want to be a.
Well,
bad
you're
guest.
you're gonna listen to it before we release, okay. And you can take out whatever. But I promise you, you won't. There's something because I'm the same way. I've been in the same situation with you. I remember. It was, I forget what episode it was, but we were talking about relationships. And at the time, I was dating a couple people, like very casually. It was all very casual. And I started talking about it. And I was like, okay, I haven't really had the talk with these girls.
Yeah.
And I started, it was the most uncomfortable I've ever felt.
Yeah.
I was like in a vice, and it just became terrible podcasting. So we're not going to do that.
Okay, that's because then I feel like I'm going to start clamming up, and then I'm going to be bad for you.
No clam.
All right,
in fact,
clam.
Every time we go to an area, as you've seen, my technique is I'll share something.
I know, you're very good at this. You're good.
In hopes that you'll... But here's the thing. I find that opening all the windows, it can be liberating, but I want them to be your windows,
sure,
not you and some other person that you have to think about and fantasize what they would feel if you thought that.
Right.
So you find out about the pregnancy, and it bums you out, and you go to the wedding, and you're thinking about this girl, and you're wondering... I think that's a brave thing to admit, and a beautiful thing to admit, that there's this person in your life that for some reason you connected, but it wasn't right. And now we're just like two old salts that should go to like a fucking New England bar and drink Cape Codders and just talk about... It's not even the one that got away. It's the one we kicked out of the way, but like still kind of... Is that what happened? Did you break up with her?
I broke up with her. And...
Did we already cover this one?
No,
is this one
yeah,
of
this
two?
Is the one that I...
This is the first
the
one.
The pregnant one?
The pregnant one
it's
is...
The seven-year one.
Is the first one.
Yeah, the first one.
Which we didn't cover.
We didn't get into her in depth.
How old were you when you started?
22 to 28, 29.
Baby Krieg style, your brother.
Yeah, right.
So 22 to 29, that's roughly when I was married.
Mm-hmm.
God, we are brothers. We're fucking secret painters, architect lovers.
We should show each other one painting we've each done, and then, but what if you don't like it? That would ruin everything.
Yeah.
Yeah, no. We shouldn't.
You're cooler than me because I tweet my paintings.
You
and
do?
Then,
you know, I've put one up on Instagram.
Okay, there you go.
I have.
And then I eagerly await.
And I did it, like, because I thought it was cool. I was totally bragging.
Yeah,
I was
totally
look at this badass
It's a brag.
Thing.
I don't even hide it. Did it get received?
Yeah,
well?
People seem to like it. It made me feel very good.
It's a good thing to do.
I know.
It's a good thing to do to give yourself permission. There's something beautiful in that act of going, I can't paint quote unquote, I have no training.
Yeah, I have no training.
I'm not supposed to paint. Mm-hmm. What the fuck is that? We live in a world where you can go to a goddamn store and buy a canvas and buy paint and then paint.
I know.
You loved painting when you were a kid.
It's crazy.
And you banged away on a piano. And you know what else you used to do? If you saw a carpet on the, you walked into a carpeted room, you'd do like a little barrel roll. And I've tried to like do that more in my life. It's totally weird and off-putting to see like a 6'6" man just barrel roll. It's fun. Fucking play more.
Dude, you know what's crazy?
Open your heart.
I'm not saying this out of an obnoxious way to segue into this thing, but like my new show that I'm doing right now is called Guys with Kids.
It's
this Fallon thing for NBC. And I am spending all day mobbed with like tons of children.
Yeah.
All day on set. And it's the best thing ever. Dude, it's like I forgot how effortless, and this is the most obvious thing, but like When I was 17, you know, or 18, I left home and I haven't, you know, been back. I've been in like New York and all these places. I've never had interactions with children my entire adult life.
Yeah.
And I've forgotten all the deal about kids.
Yep.
And it's like the first time like growing out with kids for hours and hours on end, and it's like it is insane. It is so fun. And everything is fun to them.
Yeah.
They have no, like, they're not jaded at all.
Nope.
It's crazy. I can't believe I used to be like that.
We all were like that.
I can't believe I used to be like that.
And it's weird. I just talked to Duncan Trussell about this on his podcast about kids have an open heart. I actually wrote on a post-it note. There's this place that I always stand in my kitchen when I drink water in the morning, and I see this post-it note. It just says open H, and I actually forgot. I thought I was like, do I have to go to an open house?
Uh-huh,
it means open heart.
Yeah.
It means deliberately like try to open your heart because what happens, Zach, is we start dating people and we get hurt, and then we have these secret pregnant people that we want them to love us and we want to love them for the rest of our lives. So then we start to close our hearts a little bit. But then when you see, because you got to protect it. You have to protect it. You know, it's when you're born, your heart's just like an open nerve, and you know everything affects it. That's why they're always screaming and crying, but that's also why they're ecstatic and dancing. It's both. So to become socially acceptable, we start building up a little wall around our heart, and then when you hang out with kids, just that pure. I just did a segment for my show with children last night, and we went to a gym and we worked out together.
You had children's working out?
Yeah. The joke was like, I need to get in shape for my show, so I'm going to work out.
They made you
work
out. Okay.
It was very silly, but it was incredibly fun. Everything was just like, we're going to have a pool party here at Balls, and like the way that they like accepted authority because they knew that led to more fun. Like, if we listen to this lady, we'll have more fun. Everybody drop to the ground. Everybody, we're going to do somersaults.
They're down.
If you just start clapping, they'll start clapping.
It's crazy.
You start dancing, they start dancing.
They are so dumb that they think it's fun and it's not, but they think it's fun.
And they love you. They like will genuinely love you at the end of the day.
Seriously.
At the end of the day, they were like, can we go home with Pete sort of thing? We want to be like Pete's our uncle sort of thing. I don't know.
And it's so funny because I'm sitting here thinking like, I've got kids all over me.
Yeah.
All over me all day. Like, I'm the one that engages with them. So I've got like four kids on me at all times.
Yeah.
Just jumping on. And I'm thinking, all these grown-ups are thinking, how does Zach do it?
Yeah,
he's got the kid magic.
Yeah.
And then I realize they all know anyone can do what I'm doing. They just understand that, like, they don't...
It's exhausting?
It's exhausting.
Yeah,
the kids will go forever. And they're like, look how dumb Zach is.
Right.
He's not shutting these kids down.
Save your batteries.
I'll learn it soon enough that I can't keep doing it.
I kind of don't... Well, for two things. I don't know if you should
especially
stop
at work when I've got stuff to do.
Right.
It's like... It's
I
tough.
Did tire
it's
out.
It's tough. Yeah.
I started, you know, pedal to the metal sort of thing. But also, I don't know if that's true. I think cats and kids and birds and all that sort of stuff. And I'm stealing this from Ram Dass's book.
Okay, sure. Moshe told me to read it.
Have you read Be Here Now? It's interesting.
Power of Now I'm familiar with, not Be Here Now.
Oh, I believe Be Here Now is the one that Steve Jobs read and really loved. Steve Jobs, I'm going to write Steve Jobs.
How many of the things you've written down will you get to?
At the end of the show, I read all of them.
Oh, interesting.
Well, yeah, it's kind of like this weird brain dump at the end. But Steve Jobs, Be Here Now, he has this thing that I actually really agree with. They talk about this, like, crying child, right? And, you know, he's a hippie and he's out there. Whatever you want to say about Ram Dass, I don't really care. But they talked about this.
I have Be Here Now. I have that book in my home. And I look
like
at it because it's
thing.
Beautiful to look at. That's
like
right. I'm such an idiot.
Paperback.
I'm very familiar with it.
Okay.
Why would I not?
Okay. It's okay. Never.
I'm so stupid.
All right. It's very not Be Here Now to get upset about owning it and forgetting.
Yeah, I know, right?
So maybe you remember this part. There's a child having a tantrum, and instead of like yelling at the kid, they all just kind of like calm themselves down.
I read that part like 3 days ago. I swear to God, I did. It's so insane how I could be like, I don't know it.
Brother,
course. I read that part 3 days ago.
We're the
and
same
they
person.
They were going to a hospital or something. The kid was freaking out, and they all held hands.
Held hands
quiet,
around
and the
her.
Kid just like met them on their frequency.
Yep. Yeah. That's the other thing that I think kids are really good at, and this is why I think you shouldn't sell yourself short on the compliment, which is that I think they can, and this is what Ram Dass says, kids, birds, cats can sense energy. Let's get weird and be okay
with it.
All
right, let's do it.
I think there's something about that. Like, I love doing it with cats. I love trying to calm myself and center myself, especially if it's like a, this is scratchy, she's a bitch. I love trying to...
Right.
Be like really calm, and I put my hand out and I go, hand of peace. You know what I mean? And try and get some like fucking
like, namaste.
Mountain cat. Exactly.
Namaste, scratchy.
Exactly. Uh-huh. But I mean, like, I bet kids can sense. I bet you give off like some, if, for lack of a better term, not a pheromone, but some sort of vibe.
I just like them. You know, I think that's
and
all.
And
I
think they can tell.
I genuinely like them.
And I think they can tell. But yeah. I think they're on the lookout for that.
Sure.
And then they're like, this guy seems okay.
Yeah.
Babies can read facial expressions, for example, and kids can read. Body language and all that stuff is like they don't even know they can do it, but they can tell you're mad, they can tell you're stressed. Imagine the stress of like your parents don't want to tell you things, like they don't want to tell you that they're having a hard time with bills or whatever. So a kid just has a ride to school with this giant, this fucking giant that birthed them, and you can feel this heat of anxiety coming off of them, but you don't know why. So you're just kind of left to fantasize, is it me? Is the sky falling? You know what I mean? It's like hard to be a kid. So if you run into somebody that's like, it's Daddy Kriegs, they're gonna pile onto you and be happy about that.
All right.
Steve Jobs read Be Here Now. Here's what I was going to tell you about Be Here Now. Or Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs had cancer. And I just learned that he, you know, he was kind of hippy-dippy himself.
Sure, yeah. Didn't he say everyone needs to take acid?
He did, yeah.
Somebody gave me a bunch of acid about 2 weeks ago.
Really?
I've never done acid. I've shroomed a ton, but never done it. And I'm like,
I've never.
It's in my medicine cabinet. I'm like, when will I take this?
Zach, we need to.
I don't know if I ever will.
I don't know if I'll ever do acid either, but we got to take mushrooms together. I mean, we're having.
That would be crazy.
Way too much in common.
I know.
We'll get it. We'll Sam Brown can be there and smoke
a
rug.
We need a spirit guide.
Yeah.
A sober spirit guide. Yeah. I don't know if I want Sam to do it.
No.
Especially
Sam,
after
Sam
I told his story.
Yeah.
He might.
In the middle of your
out.
Trip, he'd be like, you betrayed me, bro.
Yeah.
Yeah, acid kind of scares me, although all these guys did it and loved it, and Steve Jobs really seems to pin it to Apple's lapel and say, I'm here and I'm who I am because of acid.
Wow.
Big time.
I didn't know he was so forthright about that.
Really big. He used to give talks in colleges and he'd say, who here's done acid? Like, he'd get like a head count. He wasn't, you know, like saying you got to turn on and drop out or whatever. Mm-hmm. But he
No, certainly not.
No, but he was saying like, you need to
expand
your mind.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
But he, when he got cancer, because he was kind of like a fruitarian for most of his life and all that sort of stuff, went to the, I think it's called Gelson. No, that's a supermarket. Gerson, can you look up holistic cancer? Oh, I don't think you're going to be able to find it. For lack of a better thing, it's Gerson.
Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs, holistic cancer treatment.
Holistic cancer diet. And then type in GE and see if it fills in the rest for you. But there, what is it?
Gerson.
Gerson. Boom. The Gerson method is that... cancer, any disease can't exist in a healthy body. If your body is healthy, then everything will be cured.
Like, I don't believe that.
Okay, well, these people do.
Okay.
And
well, how do they explain genetic cancers that are unique to DNA strands?
I think what they would say, and I'm not...
Because family lines that get the exact same specific type of cancer.
I agree. Yep. Good, great point. Very good critical thinking.
Yeah.
Nice job. I like your paintings.
All right. But then again, I mean, just to go on the other side, I was watching some 60 Minutes about this Greeks and some temple.
Yeah, I saw
literally
that
too. They only Zach, eat the same plants and they never
there's
get cancer.
There's no cancer.
Yeah, I don't know.
Well,
but those guys are also Christians and God protects Christians.
That's
so they
true.
Don't get cancer.
Those weird Christians that harbored Nazis.
They probably
Nazis,
didn't sin. Yes.
That harbored Nazis.
Did they all get cancer?
They didn't. These are the same monks. Zach, we're living.
Oh, those monks did?
We're living the same lives. Whatever you've seen, I've seen.
How
just assume.
Fun. Okay.
And I don't watch 60 Minutes, but I saw that one.
Yeah, yeah.
This is fucking weird. Incense and peppermints. I don't know why. But those guys never get cancer. The correlation between like people that just, you know, I don't. I want to be sensitive here because actually, let me start with this. The punchline is, not that it's a joke, Steve Jobs. it's my understanding, went the holistic. I'm only going to eat organic fruits, like grown small garden sort of stuff. I'm just going to cleanse my body of any toxins and any acid and all that sort of stuff and just be pure, and my body will heal itself. My body wants to heal itself. Let's enable my body to heal itself. And then when it was too late, he was like, okay, let's do chemo. And they're like, it's too late. And, then he died. So it's always difficult. You can't – I would never want to recommend that. I sometimes wonder if I – you know, this is one of those superstitious moments where you're supposed to say, God forbid, if I got cancer, as if I didn't say, God forbid, I would get cancer. But anyway, if I did, I wonder if I would go the wheatgrass, only eat oranges route for myself.
I would go the chemo route, no.
It sounds that way. Yeah.
Just because I've seen it work firsthand.
It worked for your friend.
Yeah. But you know, dude, that's a choice everyone's going to make on their own. I would be very interested to see the research on the success rate of diet.
Yeah.
You know?
I
don't know nearly enough about this to have an opinion.
There's a movie on Netflix called The
Forks and Knives.
Forks Over Knives touches on it a little bit, but there's a movie. It's very bad. It's like from the 80s called The Gerson Principle or something. I don't know what it's called. Okay. Type in Gerson into Netflix and you can watch it. But I mean, it works for some people and it doesn't work for some people. I'll tell you something that's definitely true. I want that to be true because I'd like to be given control.
Totally.
Wouldn't you like to know that if you ate well, you wouldn't get cancer?
Well, what's funny is that that's basically the mandate that we're all facing on a daily basis. Like we are, you know, the odds of getting cancer is so dramatically linked directly to what you eat.
Yeah.
And I ignore it all the time. I eat red meat. I eat fast food sometimes. Yeah. I smoke cigarettes, obviously. Yeah. It's like crazy. Like, I'm totally reckless, and I know this. I know this information.
Right.
And it's...
I think, isn't that in that book, How to Quit Smoking the Easy Way? It's like...
Which actually helped me quit smoking for a long, long time.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, then you can tell me. Doesn't it say, like, hey, we know you don't care?
It says the negative effects of your health...
Nobody cares.
...is not going to affect you. Yeah. It's not going to help you quit smoking.
Because something... There's, like, some part of your brain that just goes, not me, or...
Yeah, because that's why... You know, and have you read The Denial of Death by Ernst Becker?
No, okay, but I believe that's Marin's favorite book.
I believe it is too. Yeah. But that talks about the same thing. Where like we all think we're the one. That's why there are soldiers, you know, that will run into face first.
Yeah.
You know, firing squads in the trenches.
Yeah.
Because they think my buddy's going to get shot somewhere deep in their soul.
But
I'm not going to
every
get shot.
Movie we've ever seen, we think we're the hero and he always makes it.
Exactly.
That's why we love those, like, War of the Worlds where, like, a car flips over Tom Cruise and it doesn't hit him. Mm-hmm. That's, if you're seeing the movie, that's how your life has been.
And you know what's really interesting? And I'm not sure if I read this in Denial of Death or this is my just own idea right now. I'm not going to take credit for it. But the idea that's coming to me is like, that whatever's in our blood and our genes that makes us behave that way, almost self-sacrificing because we're so sure we're going to be immortalized,
yeah,
is maybe invaluable to the propagation of the species, because you need those lemmings to take the bullet for people to keep going. If everyone's a coward, we'd probably die out a lot sooner because no one would take the fire to the next village. You know what I mean?
Brilliant. A lot of stories about reincarnation, not just my man JC, but other people, you know, transcending this life or like overcoming death, defeating death, and then teaching us to love and be gracious and forgive and help and all that sort of stuff. It's basically really helpful to teach people that they're immortal.
Yeah.
And that they'll be rewarded.
I remember being told in youth group, this youth minister getting up, being like, everyone in this room is immortal. And then he takes his idiotic, didactic, dramatic pause and goes, I'm going to say one more time, everyone in this room is immortal. What do you think? It's all up to you. You're going to live the rest of eternity in heaven, or you're going to live in... It's just you know what I'm talking
about.
I don't know
so
why
upset.
I just launched in that story.
No, I know why you did, Zach, because that was the best part of the podcast so far. That really troubles me. I'm so troubled. I see the room. I see the guy. I see the kids.
Oh, that guy's such a dick.
You know
dick.
What I mean? We all know that
I
guy.
I hate that guy.
He's a super dick. It's so troubling. That, to me, when I hear that guy, it makes me
sad. It's fish in a barrel because 13 and 14-year-olds are just like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, it's unfair.
I just saw my first pomegranate, and now you're telling me that there's hell. Uh-huh. I didn't know there were pomegranates. There must be hell, too. And, like, he... You know, there's almost like something like getting off about it. Like, I'm going to tell these kids the way it is, and their believing faces will affirm my belief. Because somewhere deep in the basement of that guy's subconscious, he's kind of like, this might be baloney. You know what I mean?
And that has to be true.
I feel like when I believed, I would get really upset when I remember a specific meal where my brother was like, doing the cliche argument. And it is a cliche argument. It doesn't mean it's a bad argument. But he's like, so you mean a Tibetan monk who's a monk his whole life and loves and serves Buddha, dies, goes to hell because he doesn't have Jesus? And I'm like, stop, shut up. You know what I mean? Like, I got really upset about that. Or like, you know, people also love the guy that lives a good life and does his best and loves people and helps people and is gracious and forgiving and good but doesn't have Christ. And I would be like, well, you know, your goodness doesn't mean anything. You need Jesus. And it's like, so yeah, he goes to hell. And that would trouble me so much. Because I think he was shining a light on something that was very hard for me to admit, which was like I didn't really believe that.
Right.
You know what I mean? So
how could you? It's a horrific thing to believe.
It's
that the God that you worship would send someone to eternal damnation because of something like that.
Right.
That calls into question such. Are you just so blindly ignorant yourself that you would go along? Like,
kind of,
I mean, that
in
is
a
insane.
Seinfeld way, who
it's
is this
insane.
God? Who is this God?
You know, I engaged recently with someone on Facebook. Someone in my feed had this Chick-fil-A thing up that said, you know, it was very pro-Chick-fil-A. And it was about, you know, how can the mayor of Boston, you know, make this judgment? And I wrote back. I couldn't help it. And I never should have done this. But I wrote back. I was like, he's not upset about the money. It's more about, like, about the guy not being able to open his shop. It's about Chick-fil-A. It's not just about his beliefs. It's that they're funding, you know, these organizations that are actively opposing gay marriage. And that's why we're upset. It's not about his opinion. It's about what he's doing with his money.
Right.
And she wrote back this thing about the Bible says this and the Bible says that. And I went on. I just like did all this research, you know, because it's so easy to find this research. You know, it takes 5 minutes. It's very lazy. But, you know, the Old Testament says things like, the word of God is unchanging for all time. Okay, that's one thing. Then it talks about how if you work on Sunday, you should be murdered.
Mm-hmm.
If you eat this, you should be murdered.
Right.
If you wear this, you should be murdered.
Yeah.
And the word of God is unchanging, right? So that's just still true today. So are we going to cherry pick, you know, the things that we're going to use the Bible to beat people over the head with, or are we going to like hold it to its word and admit that the Bible, as a moral compass, is horrible?
Right.
Is absolutely wrong.
Well, it's actually interesting.
It also advocates slavery and rape.
Yeah, yeah.
Literally rape and slavery.
Well, there's
it's
a lot
insane.
Of rape. There's a lot of
it. And God is telling God you, God from his mouth is like, go rape these people.
There's God-endorsed rape.
It's insane.
Yeah.
Am I wrong about this? What am I missing?
No.
I would love someone who knows more about this to be on this podcast to like retort me because I...
I'll do my best.
Give it, go.
Well, when Christ came, he was the fulfillment of the law.
But I'm going to go back to the word of God is unchanging.
But can't we change that part? Here comes Jesus.
Oh, you're going to change the part that says it's unchangeable?
Yeah, we change the other parts. Why not change that part?
Well, that right there
also,
is
what
bullshit.
Okay, right. Okay. What I would say as a former believer, what I would say about all of that is that, well, you know, first of all, it's a good point you're making. let me say that.
But
secondly,
give me the Pete Holmes of 20 years. What would 20-year-old Pete say to that?
About those laws, I would open with Christ being the fulfillment of the law.
He changed what said it would never be changed.
Yep.
Well, do you see the crazy how I could not accept that?
Sure. Also, there's two creation stories. That's more fun.
In the Bible?
Genesis 1 has two creation stories, one where the animals are created first and one where man is created first.
I did not know that.
Yeah, so if you want to get into the literacy of the Bible, just start with Genesis 1.
All right.
And that, okay, right there, we can't say God said it, I believe it, that does it. You can't say that anymore because we're dealing with the Hebrews and we're dealing with people that like don't engage with the Bible and didn't write it in the way that we look at, that we read the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus was not being followed around by people holding iPhones with their voice recorders out. You know what I mean? There's incredible discrepancies between the four Gospels, and that's the point. These are myths, and myth is such an offensive word. I would have been so deeply offended if someone called the Bible a myth. I mean a myth in like a good way. I mean in we're supposed to wrestle with the discrepancies and the differences and questions like you're asking. What you're asking right now, that's rabbis jams right there.
Okay.
They love that.
Right.
They go, so does that change? The word of God is unchanging. I don't want to do a stereotypical rabbi voice. And they would get into it. Unfortunately, somewhere during the pasteurization and the homogenization of Judaism and into mainstream Christianity, we lost all of that wrestle and we turned the Bible into this book of answers. And we were like, it's in here, it's in black and white, that's the end of the discussion. When really, I think it's more like the Bible's a jungle gym that you're supposed to get in there and get dirty, much like Jacob wrestling the angel.
That's really interesting. You know, this is another thing I talk about with Moshe at length.
Hey, this is Moshe.
I know.
That's his voicemail. That's his voicemail.
I know, his voicemail is so unenthusiastic. It's so, like, hey, it's Moshe. I'd really prefer you not leave me a message.
I always say it sounds like he just fucked a girl and they're in the morning and he's asking her if she wants breakfast. Like, hey, it's Moshe. You want eggs? So I've never left him a message without 15 impressions of his greeting. Yeah.
And you're right to do that.
Yeah. So I'm sorry. You were just talking about Moshe.
You know,
about this.
I think for me, it's like I was so burned by Christianity in my youth. I really had so much bitterness coming out of it. And I think it had slingshot me, you know, the other way, where I'm very, I don't respect any religion. And,
okay.
I judge people that are religious, and I don't think it's wrong.
Good for
and
you.
Moshe was like, well, you're a bigot. And I'm like, no, I'm not a bigot. It's a decision that you've made. It's not. I'm not judging you by your race or your age or your gender or your sexuality. I'm judging by you, something that you have decided to believe.
Okay.
I'm gauging your character. Now, Moshe put me in my place. We
please
Googled the word bigot, and it says someone who judges someone based off of their religion, gender, blah, blah, blah. So I guess technically I am a bigot. And Moshe was also saying, like, Moshe brought up a great point where he's like,
you're a bigot.
I am a bigot. I'm in the Whitest Kids U Know. No, but he brought up a really great point. He was like, listen, there has never in recorded history ever been a culture that was absent some sort of spiritual dogma.
Mm.
It is as endemic to the human existence as breathing oxygen. And even the atheists and the communists, you know, that you can call whatever you want, you know, atheism. And a lot of people would really argue with me, and I am not equipped to argue this point, but I will say that, you know, I have the same disdain for atheists that I do for devout religious people, because I just don't trust certainty. You know, if you are certain, how can you be?
We share that in common. I get in trouble every time atheists come up, and I'm sorry, atheists. I really do love atheists. I always say
I'd rather hang out with them than anybody else. But
so many of my friends are lovely atheists, and they're thoughtful atheists. But I do get. And atheists would say, like, we're not saying we have it figured out. They would say, we think the cards point to most likely no God. That's some of the atheists
no, say no. No shit. Yeah, sure they do. But, like, is there something else about the interconnectedness of all?
It's weird.
Valid.
See, here's the kind of believer I am. When I do my laundry and I dump it out on the bed, I notice that my socks are often together. You know what I mean? The socks.
Please tell me that's not really what you...
This is real.
Okay.
I'm telling you something very weird that I've never told anybody. So I do my laundry, and it gets tumbled in the wash. It gets tumbled in the dryer. Then I dump it out on my bed, and every time I notice that the socks are almost always together. What are the chances? These are, you know, I have different kinds of socks.
Cling. The chances are high. Your socks are static cling. They're the slightest things in there. It makes total sense that they would
gravitate
towards each other
in the dryer. No, I'm talking about varieties of socks. They should be sticking to random socks. They're sticking to their pairs. You know what I mean? Not every time, Zach. But here's the thing.
To look at your socks in the dryer and be like, there's a God, is, come on.
No, I'm not here to say that's not right. But I'm also here to say that I look at my socks and I go,
thanks, God.
Thanks, God.
Thanks, Jason.
Why? Because I'm stupid. I'm not here to say I'm not stupid. I'm a happy.
I'm not saying that either.
I'm saying you're incorrect. Yes.
Yeah.
I'm saying I'm incorrect too. You think I.
But then again, how can I be so arrogant to claim.
But Zach,
you know.
I don't believe in a God that's putting my socks together.
Okay.
You're now talking to my rational brain, okay? Do you like him? He's pretty interesting. Now talk to my emotional brain. Socks together! I'm never going to die! I have both of these things. I have two different and opposing running softwares all the time. And one of them is an idiot, happy pattern recognition guy that goes, you read the fucking page of Ram Dass 3 days ago that I talked to you about in a conversation about children? And I'm like, oh, okay.
Also, I just randomly went to that page, read that page.
Sure.
That's true. That's crazy.
That's crazy.
That's
so
crazy.
Forget God. I love you, God. You know, whatever you are.
Uh-huh.
I'm looking for you. Please help me.
Yeah.
But let's just talk, like, I'm the kind of guy that would be like, that's interesting to me. Chemistry of our brains. I don't know if it's supernatural at all.
Right.
Where were we going? I had a point.
Let
me say this to you. You, like me, being raised Christian, I wonder if you would have the same delight and joy that I had in reconciling with my religious upbringing. Meaning, being completely okay saying the Bible is not to be taken literally. You know what I mean? Meaning, I hate that fucking youth pastor telling us that it's that we're all going to live forever and it's up to us how we spend that time. I hate the pastor. Richard Brooks has this bit about a seagull picking up a grain of sand and flying to the moon, dropping it off, and flying back, getting another grain of sand, and doing an entire beach. That's like one day of eternity. Oh. And that, you know, and I'm like, fuck you and your fucking manipulative propaganda. Yeah. God, fuck you.
I got to interrupt. I remember a guy being like, imagine you're in a field of silver dollars the size of the state of Texas.
Yeah.
These silver dollars are 20 feet deep, and there's only one that is heads on two sides, and you're blind, and you're randomly dropped in the state of Texas, and you bend down, and you just so happen to pick up that one silver dollar that is two-sided.
Yeah,
or heads on
yeah, two-headed.
Side. Two-headed, thank you. Those are the odds of the world being created with mankind as we are. So what do you... It's like, really?
Yeah.
That's your model for why there's a God?
Yeah. And I have friends that were the stupidest people I knew growing up who are now leading churches. It breaks my heart.
It's
it breaks
beyond my heart. Stupid. It's... Also, it's immediately like, well, that's like great odds because yeah. in an infinite, you know, a combination universe, that would happen an infinite amount of times.
Right.
So, of course, it happened way.
Here's what you get mad at, and it's the same thing I get mad at.
I resent being manipulated.
Certainty yes. being fed to children and manipulating them with
that. Without the facilities to make choices for themselves.
Of course. Well, before your brain's fully formed, here's some truths that you'll never be able to shake.
Yeah, because I still, honestly, if I'm totally honest, I still have crazy conflict and guilt and weird shit.
Of course.
It lingers.
Here's what I want to do. Here's what I want to do.
Okay.
I wonder if I can give you this gift that I kind of was given by other people and helped me. The term culturally Christian comes up on the show sometimes, and I consider myself culturally Christian, meaning I'm no longer affiliated with that church per se, but I'm like an Easter Christmas guy. You know what I mean? Like those things were in me. Guilt is in me.
Do you believe Jesus died for your skin? For your skin. For your sin.
Here's what I believe. Do you want to know?
Yes.
Joseph Campbell, man. Have you done any Joseph Campbell?
No.
You got it. Oh, my God. I will send it. Give me your address, and I will send you. I just sent these to Mulaney. I love these so much. He talks about – he just said something so beautiful, and it's on Netflix. It's called The Hero's Journey or something. I think it's called A Hero's Journey. His thing is basically – you've heard it kind of probably been plagiarized before or you know, paraphrased before – is the idea that all these religions and all these things are kind of the same. Myths – religions are metaphors, right? And metaphor being like they're not lies. They're just not meant to be taken as literal truths. So when they talk about Christ's virgin birth, for example, his thing is that doesn't mean that Jesus literally was born of a virgin. He's like, that's retarded. Like, fucking shut up. And I'm sorry for saying retarded. But he's like, that's stupid. What he's saying is we all need to have this sexless rebirth in our hearts. Mean it also when Jesus ascends to heaven and Mary, shortly after Jesus, without dying, ascends to heaven. A great weird thing to point out when you're talking to people about the Bible. Jesus, without dying, goes to heaven, just leaves earth. That doesn't mean that that's what we're supposed to aspire to. It means that we're supposed to, like, spiritually, intellectually, inside of ourselves, die to ourselves, be reborn to ourselves, ascend to heaven, find nirvana. All these things are things that we're supposed to do in this life now. And it doesn't necessarily mean a literal death and resurrection of Christ. That's a story to teach us about forgiveness. That's a story to teach us about God's love. That's a story about teaching us about brotherhood and how to learn.
That's so beautiful.
It's like, so yeah, it is beautiful. And
yeah.
I'm not saying it
I don't say
one
that,
100th
I don't
way
say that
at
with
all.
Any sarcasm.
I don't think
that's
I didn't
beautiful.
Feel any
yeah.
sarcasm. You will get your dick blown off by Joseph Campbell.
I don't want to read it then because
I
use my dick all the time.
Yeah, get it wet. It's okay. We're just supposed to grow from the inside. So thank you, Katie. So the idea being for me,
did you just get the wrap it up sign?
No. I like knowing when we're at 90 minutes.
Oh, gotcha.
The thing for me was I was so mad at my youth pastor. I was so mad at my pastor. I was so mad at the pastor of mission. So mad at these people at my church. Angry. Hate in my heart. The
sure.
Bible. I hardened my heart towards yeah. these fuckers. I fucking hated them. And I wanted to be an atheist. I hated all of it. I was like, fuck this bullshit. I wanted to like confront my mother. I wanted to tell.
And I've done that with my mom.
Yeah,
and
sure.
And it doesn't ever go the way you think.
Yes.
Never.
Right. I'd love to hear about that.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that right now. But the point here was when I allowed myself to go, those are values that are important to me, for better or worse, grace, turns me on. Mm-hmm. Forgiveness turns me on. Even to a certain degree, even though here I am saying it's going to blow your dick off and stuff, I like a certain degree of modesty. I like a certain degree of politeness. Mm-hmm. I like a certain degree of like churchy behavior or whatever, somewhere in me. Just acknowledging that and allowing myself to be like, that's how I was raised. That shit's in my attic somewhere. I'm not going to fight against my nature. And allow my rational brain, who we met with the socks.
Gotcha.
Allow him to know what we know about science and religion and myth and all that sort of stuff. But also allow stupid sock brain to go like, I like me some Jesus. Just the name Jesus has a tie to me.
Really?
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Even though I love to blaspheme, I love blaspheming. Goddamn is one of my favorite things to do. So tell me where you're at.
Well, you know,
I
love these conversations because I do feel like, and it's so weird. I think it's one of my best qualities, one of my worst is that I can very much, I hear what you're saying, and it's like, I can feel it shifting my,
right.
my center of gravity already.
Isn't that interesting? And I love open people. I love trying to be. Yeah. It's like what we're talking about with kids, having an open heart.
Yeah. And I think I need time to kind of digest what you're saying.
Sure.
And I think there's definite truth in that. There's definite wisdom there that I have not wrestled with.
Seriously,
yet.
Give me your address. I'll send
sure,
it to
I
you.
Sure. I will. I would love to,
yeah,
to watch
yeah.
it.
Well, we can leave it at that. I don't need to put you on the spot. I can sum up where I'm at
like in 5 seconds is, you know, I totally have bitterness in me. I'm repulsed by organized religion, but I'm with you. I know I don't have the answers, and I know there's something bigger. And I have not searched as ardently as I should, and
right.
I feel guilt about that.
Yeah.
I have inertia for whatever reason, you know.
I know why. It's too much. Joseph Campbell is so interesting. I watch it 10 minutes at a time, and I turn it off because it's just too much to talk about this stuff all the time, to think about this stuff all the time. It'll kill you.
Yeah.
I think we can agree on this, that that truth, whatever truth there might be encased in Christianity, the kind that we were given, some sort of pearl in the center of that nonsense, was lost to us, and we're both disgusted by that sort of like, this is the way it is.
Right.
You're going to hell. I know.
And that is wrong. That is worthy of hate.
It is wrong.
It's worthy of hate.
It's stupid, and it's not very thoughtful.
No.
That I know, there was a guy at my church who, I it's come up on the show before, but it was this real moment where he like really was shaking me down, asking me how I could be a Christian and be a comedian. You know what I mean? He doesn't even know how I've digressed, in his opinion, since then, gotten dirtier, talking more about sex, talking more about religion, whatever I want to talk about. He's just like, how can you do that? And, you know, I got the feeling that he wanted to be a comedian and was looking at me jealously. And then, like, I just was fucking talking about this in therapy. I know that guy goes to bed and goes like, well, he's a comedian and I could never be a comedian, but he's going to hell.
Right.
And that helps him sleep.
Sure.
Fuck you, dickbag. I'm going to piss on your face from my better heaven. Fuck you. And it's my heaven because I get to piss on his face. Fuck you, man. What a fucking monster to go around damning people and finding pleasure in it.
Dude, people are warped.
People are warped.
People are warped.
So your brother goes to Gordon.
He went to Gordon.
That's right. And now he might get engaged. That's interesting to me because I wonder if your relationship with your brother, because you were like, my brother went to Gordon and I didn't even know he was so religious. And my brother also didn't really know I was that religious.
Right.
Because it's not really a passive choice to go to a religious school.
I don't know, man. Yeah, I don't know how much. First of all, he went to a religious elementary school.
Oh. How did you dodge this?
Dude, I hit 14 and I turned punk rock and I was so angry and so you couldn't drag me.
I was punk rock.
No, you weren't.
I was.
I was real punk rock.
I had a leather jacket with spikes on it.
I had patches all over my clothes. I went to punk shows every weekend in D.C.
I went to punk shows every weekend.
Get out of here.
In Boston. I wonder if we saw any of the same bands.
Did you go to the Showcase Showdown? That's a Boston punk
Showcase
band.
Showdown.
I like that
I saw Showcase Showdown 15. Sure. Bob Barker's Innocent.
I was into the Boyles, the Goons, the Suspects.
I'm wearing
Society,
a Showcase Showdown.
Crusty
Casualties.
Sure, everyone.
They were so scary. They were so scary.
Dude, I have a skinhead punk band staying at my house tonight. They're going to get in at midnight.
No.
Yeah,
who?
From San Francisco. They're called the Bad Coyotes. They're driving down. Because all my punk friends, all moved to San Francisco, a lot of them.
The same person.
And they're like, called me and they're like, dude, we need to crash on your floor. And I was like, I'm working early the next day. And like, no worries, we'll be real quiet. And then they call me like, do you like tequila? And I'm like, this is going to go bad.
Tequila, the least sleepy liquor.
Yeah.
The stay up liquor.
Okay, my skinhead punk friends and tequila, and I have a network walkthrough at 8 a.m. How is this going to go?
Your show's multicam?
Yeah.
Let's talk about your show.
We really don't have to.
I know. Okay. I can tell you want to talk about the show. I just was proud of myself for knowing what a network walkthrough is. Anyway, I'm wearing a Showcase Showdown t-shirt in my senior picture.
That's great.
Or my junior picture.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. It's so weird. And the casualties on their 7-inch said lots of beer too for the thanks and lots of puke too for the people that they hated. Those guys were serious. They looked terrifying.
I had some interactions with the casualties in my life that are all the same, and they're all terrible. The D.C. scene was very...
You hung out with the casualties?
I hung out with one in New York, and he was a dick, but then there's this...
How?
We were at the same club, and he was trying to hit on a girl I was with, and he was like, tell her I'm in the casualties, and I'm cool. I was like, just because you're in that band doesn't mean I'm going to vouch for you. He's like, I'm in the casualties.
Oh, my God.
I was like, that's not enough, man.
That must be so frustrating, because punk rock
I was like, I loved your band as a kid, but I can't do that.
Did he still have a huge mohawk?
Yeah, dude, he was the same. It was crazy.
Whoa. Punk rock famous is kind of like country famous, although country's bigger now. It's kind of like wrestling famous.
Yeah.
They have to be a fan to give a shit about you.
Yeah.
What about, you didn't know The Unseen?
You know, I think I might have hung out with The Unseen in Brooklyn one night when I was very young.
Really?
It was crazy. First of all, we had like shows at my house when I was a kid.
What?
I would go to, my brothers and like four punk bands now.
What?
To this day. Different brothers.
Okay.
I was very, very active in the punk world.
And you played in a punk band?
No, which to my deep regret, I was in a ironic punk band for a little while. We did a few shows, but I was like a peripheral member, and I was not. I would be a liar if I said I was in a punk band.
Okay.
Okay.
Well,
just leave it at that.
Yeah.
I wish I was so bad, so badly. I wish I was.
You but still
I,
could.
I could, right? There's nothing cooler than a 32-year-old who decides to start a punk.
Isn't
band.
That what Blink 182 did? I feel like they started late.
No, no way.
No? That was a rumor then.
Well, I can't imagine.
Do you like pop punk like that?
Yeah, I think Operation Ivy was kind of my gateway drug into punk, and I don't really consider them a pop punk, but they're certainly popular. I ended up getting really into dark. Dark punk, like grindcore, bands like Destroy and Napalm Death, obviously, and things like that. Brutal of the dark, like dystopian. His Hero's Gone and things like that.
Dark in the sound or the lyrics,
like,
really?
Like blast beats, like the whole song. That
Whoa.
Sort of thing.
See,
yeah.
What is that? Because here we are.
It was
are.
Called Power Violence. Charles Bronson was a band that kind of started this movement. I would say I could be wrong.
Well, here we are. You're on a show. What's on that? Which network?
Guys with Kids, where I am a dad of two lovable kids.
That's the multicam show?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. For some reason, I don't know where I got off track. So you're on this network show. It's on
NBC.
NBC. And we are both, I never know how to put this, but we're both like, kind of like Norman Rockwell-y American looking, just kind of like
regular
guys.
I can put on clothes and look like a Mormon.
Exactly. That's sure. Okay, both of us could pass for Mormons.
With the right wardrobe.
Both of us grew up religious, you know what I mean? And like both of us occasionally blast really hardcore punk music in our cars.
Totally. Totally.
What's going on there?
I don't know. Like, I will rock Born Against on my way to work as a dad on a sitcom, and I'll be listening to literally blasphemous, filthy punk rock music.
Yeah.
And I think I need it.
Well, does it open the anger valve a little bit for
No,
you?
It's just blown off steam. It's not even about anger anymore.
What
it's just
kind
about,
of
like,
steam?
This is awesome.
Which steam is it blowing off?
Maybe it's nostalgia steam. Maybe,
I love nostalgia
maybe
steam.
Maybe it's just something about like the audacity of me to be, on the NBC lot listening to some guy screaming about, who knows?
Yeah.
Do you know Born Against? Were you ever
no.
Knew? That was my favorite band.
No.
And there's this, when I was like 16, I was playing video games in my basement listening to them, and my very Christian mom came in with a load of laundry. In the beginning of their album, before they start, they're tuning their guitars, and the singer goes, this is exactly what he goes. He goes, hello, shit. we're born against, so suck my fucking lizard. And then they go, and my mom just stopped dead in her tracks. It's like, no, no, no. And like, give it to me. It was the...
Hello, shit. Suck and, my lizard.
But of all the things, we're born against, like directly to my mom. Suck my fucking
lizard.
Like,
instead of born again.
Born against.
I just got that. Yeah. Born against.
So good. They were a great band.
They sound great.
And the singer, Sam McPheeter, still does great music. I think he lives in San Diego.
I want to, again, I'm interested, I don't mean to force this issue, but I'm interested in the idea. You said you don't fight with your girlfriends, or some of them.
You know, once in a blue moon, but sure. I'm not a combative dude.
So neither am I.
Right.
In fact, I've been really struck with how much I'll endure before I'll be like, hey, yeah. You know what I mean? Like it takes a lot to get me to that level. I'm getting better at that as an older person because I'm learning that people won't take their love away if you tell them what you really think.
Right.
Which is hard for me. Sure. But then this punk rock stuff. What's that band where there's two singers, two male singers? It's called
Capitalist Casualties. All Else Failed. I don't know.
No. They're shit. They're not like cool. Taking Back Sunday. Another.
That is the kind of shit I did not get into.
No. I get that.
Okay.
I'm fine with that. I got into that later because all of their songs are about there's so many songs where it's just like. They're just screaming, and there's something overwhelming about the sound. It's very produced and deep and whatever. Mm. It's not cool. I'm not here to say it's cool.
Right.
But I would listen. I went through this bad relationship, and I would blast Any Given Sunday. Mm. Not a proud of this.
Taking Back Sunday.
Taking Back Sunday. I blast the speech from Any Given Sunday, and that's the only time that I could like cry.
Interesting.
That was the only thing that would get me crying. Yeah. And there was another, there's a song by Rancid that I still occasionally will listen to where the chorus is just let California fall into the fucking ocean. They just yell that
California
over.
California to fall into the sea.
It's a different song.
Who's that? That's
I don't
the
know
Youth
who
Brigade
that
or somebody. I don't know who that is.
Well, maybe that's right. A punk rock theme is the idea of getting rid of California. But I would listen to it because I just moved to California. I was with this girl and she was making me so angry that I would blast the song and just yell along with it. It's like the safe place to be angry. It's a safe place to play the emotion game.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas in our lives, I'm wondering if you're the same way, we should just be accessing these emotions regularly instead of going to the Middle East on a Saturday and slam dancing. Still.
That's where you went with going to the Middle East? I thought you were going to say going to the Middle East and... I was going to go in a dark place with that. Okay,
The Middle East is a club in Cambridge.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
Didn't know. I don't know that club. Okay. Yeah.
So are you using music to feel?
I'm not. And sometimes I avoid music that makes me feel too much because I just can't go there.
Yeah.
You know, some of my favorite albums, I'm just like, I'm just not ready for this right now.
Yeah.
I think I need something dumb.
What do you listen to the most regularly?
You know, I have so many different things. I'm really into world music these days.
Really?
Yeah, I'm obsessed with a lot of like Brazilian music and a lot of African music and
Italian
stuff. I listen to, you know... all sorts of things, dude. I'm very eclectic. I'm obnoxious. I could start naming things, but I would feel very pretentious.
Yeah.
I'd rather not.
I'm not making fun.
Sure.
I've made fun of world music before.
Okay.
Just the idea of world music, that there's U.S. music.
You know what? There's music
world.
Out there that is just as good as the best we've got, and it just doesn't get heard because it's so obscure and they're not singing our language.
Really?
Yeah.
I'd love a playlist. I really would.
All right. I'll throw one album out there, and you listen to it.
Please.
And you know, it's on Spotify and iTunes. It's called it's by this guy, Jorge Ben, Jorgeben, and that album is called A Tabua de Esmeralda. And it's
I'm just gonna go with Jorge.
Yeah, Beck. just but you gotta get this the right. He's got a lot of albums.
Okay, what is it?
Just look for A Tabua, TABUA. It's pretty. And if you want to get to the meat of it, write this down because you're gonna thank me.
Yeah.
Zumbi, the song Zumbi, Zumbi. Okay, people at home,
there
if you listen to that song, you don't like it, then you don't have to listen to anything else I say. I will stand behind it.
Can I just tell you this?
Sure.
I've brought it up before. Soul music,
love it.
I don't know why I listen to anything else.
Yeah, Sam Cooke, what else do you need?
Dude, get the fuck out of my house.
Let's
it's Sam Cooke that
this.
I've been listening
let's
to.
Let's talk about this
it's
about Sam Cooke.
Sam Cooke.
You know how Sam Cooke died?
There's a God, Zach.
Do you know how Sam Cooke died?
Sam Cooke, there's a God.
Dude, he's the
okay,
best.
Okay, go on.
Do you know how he died?
Because we both... How?
You don't know?
No.
Oh, baby, here we go. You ready to get your heart broken?
Yeah.
Sam Cooke, Los Angeles, the year he died, probably, I don't know what, 70-something? I don't know. Got a prostitute.
No.
Got a ton of crack.
No.
Went to a seedy hotel.
No.
Smoked the crack.
No.
Got naked.
No.
Had a butcher knife.
No.
threatened the woman.
No.
Scared her.
No.
She took all his clothes and her clothes because they're all in the same pile.
No.
Ran into the night.
No.
He had a trench coat.
No.
Put that on. With the knife, chased her out into the night, lost her, went to the hotel office, kicked the door in, wielding a butcher knife, naked in the trench coat, saying, "Where's that bitch?" Woman working behind the desk pulled out a shotgun and iced him. Murked him.
What?
He got murked by a scared woman running a motel at 4 in the morning.
Holy
with
fuck.
A shot. The guy with the most beautiful, sensitive, godly voice I've ever heard in my life, murked over high on crack, wielding a knife, naked in a trench coat, in the lobby of a shitty motel in Los Angeles.
I'm feeling every emotion.
Is that insane?
Yeah.
When I heard that, I was like, excitement? Because it's so perversely thrilling and crazy, but
yeah.
also like profound depression.
Yeah.
Because it's like, if somebody who can move me like that can
yeah.
fall to that level. But you know what? I mean, what do we expect? I mean, I guess... So
what's
many
that song
amazing...
that goes like this? I was born.
That's called A Change Is Gonna Come.
A Change Is Gonna Come.
That is amazing.
I put Sam Cooke into my Pandora and it played that song, and then it played, sometimes Pandora will do this and fuck up, kind of, played someone else doing it. And I was listening to it this morning on the way to uh-huh. Warner Brothers, blasting it, took the park, went through Griffith
sure.
Park. Sure. Windows down, alone on the road, like tearing up and belting it. I was just like, this is music.
I had rented a convertible at one point for like a weekend. I don't know why. And I'm so scared in convertibles to play any music because
yeah.
I feel like everyone's judging me. But Sam Cooke was one thing where I was like, I can go to 11. I don't give a fuck. If
yep.
anyone judges
yep.
this, they're wrong.
Buddy.
Fuck it.
When I park, I have to get out and move a cone.
Uh-huh.
And in that moment, whatever I'm listening to
everyone
is going to...
Everyone hears.
And it's often like Jack Johnson or some weak shit.
Uh-huh.
And when it's Sam Cooke, I don't even turn
yeah.
it down. I go, you're welcome.
Yeah.
You're welcome, Burbank.
Yeah.
Ugh. Fucking great.
Yeah, dude.
I don't
you
know.
You should also get into Brenton Wood is pretty great, and Percy Sledge are two great ones. Two good soul dudes. Also.
Wait, say it again?
Brenton Wood, he sings like, Ugga, Bugga, 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 Ba-da-la-da-la-la. He's really great.
I like that.
And
Brenton
Percy
Wood.
Sledge, he's famous for singing When a Man Loves a Woman, but he has some other, like, Dark End of the Street, which are just total gems.
Oh, that's great. Can we, oh my God, we got to wrap up.
All right, dude, this has been so fun.
Oh, yeah. Can I ask you one more thing?
Yeah.
Because you made a movie and we didn't even talk about
it.
You don't like talking about it?
Dark times, dark times.
Okay, because I saw that movie.
You didn't.
In the theaters.
Do you want money?
What I want to know, Zach, and not in a shock jock
you
way.
You know, and I'm very, I'm overly down on that movie. I think Trevor wouldn't.
The reason I thought of it, is that a shirt from
this
it?
The grips from that movie gave me this shirt. So this is like the grip shirt.
That's why I thought of it. I wasn't, sometimes
right.
I like doing the show and not asking the obvious thing.
Right.
But I remember we talked about it when it came out.
Did
and,
we?
And
was
you,
I very down on it then?
A little bit.
Yeah, probably.
I laughed really hard when you shit yourself in that movie.
Oh.
I laughed really
At least
hard.
I didn't have to stoop too low to get that shirt. We CGI'd that shit.
You did?
Well, half CGI and half practical, yeah. Crazy.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
That's a lot of shit.
Yeah.
I remember I said to you, I was like, so you made that movie and you were like, that's funny, that's what everybody says because they don't want to offer an opinion. Like your painting, this is why you're hiding your paintings.
Right.
Because of Miss March.
Sure.
That's
could
why
be.
People are missing your paintings.
Could be.
Yeah. But you said people would come up and be like, well, you made a movie. I remember getting really kind
that's
of.
That's what everyone said too. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, at least you made the movie.
I got it.
It's like if somebody else says that to me, I'm going to fucking crack them
yeah,
in the jaw.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, hey, at least you got a movie made. That's a tough thing to do
ugh,
in this industry.
Ugh.
I appreciate that. I'm aware of that.
I remember the scene where your names, you and Trevor's names, fade up. Written and directed. Mm. Directed?
Yeah.
Written and directed by, and it comes up. It's like a school or something.
I don't know, yeah.
Yeah, I remember. It's like a tree in a school.
Yeah.
It's an outdoor shot, and I was like, holy fuck. So it didn't do well.
No, not creatively, commercially, or artistically. Oh, creatively, I meant critically.
Did it? It doesn't have like some weird college following.
You know, it does actually. It has a big cult following, and it's actually been getting a lot of play in places like HBO and
yeah, I see
TNT
it on HBO
and like Showtime. Like, it's getting more play now than ever before. It's weird, dude. It was trending recently. It was trending on Twitter.
Really?
I don't know.
Isn't
don't know.
That kind of some sort of beautiful justice there?
Yeah, I don't know if it's
I don't know
justice.
If it's justice,
dude,
but you know what I mean.
Like, I haven't seen that movie since the day it came out of theater.
Really?
No, it's too painful for me to watch.
Was this a dark? Like
it was
sad?
A very dark.
Depression.
Time I was very wounded.
Really?
Yeah, really, really.
Well, you seem sensitive. I mean, paintings.
Sure, no.
We're all sensitive.
Right, who's not?
You're me, so I'll just assume you're as sensitive as I am.
You know, but it was wounded in a couple different ways. First of all, I felt like, is there a comedy show happening downstairs?
Yeah, I'm
that,
on it,
is
too.
Is that the dude? Okay, I know that guy.
Yeah.
It's, to be in, to have such an opportunity and to blow it hurts real bad. But to do it in such a public, that movie got 5% on Rotten Tomatoes. That's brutal.
Oh wow!
And to be have it be so public, and so, there was a lot of vitriol. I didn't read any of the critics, but you know, I was told it was,
yikes,
it was ugly.
Yeah,
and I was. Dude, I didn't want to do that movie in the first place. I was 26 years old. It was just not. I wasn't ready.
Yeah,
I just wasn't ready.
What did you learn? And you're doing another movie.
I'm not. Well, we'll see if it gets made. We're writing a movie right now.
So, what did you learn between that one and this one?
Integrity matters. Don't just take it because it's available if you know it's the wrong
interesting
thing. You know?
Yeah. It's like Extras. Did you watch Extras? The idea of like kind
I
of
did
making
when it came
it
out years ago. Yeah.
You know, in the second season, they cover that sort of like just because.
Oh, right,
because
he gets the show and he's like, hey, oh, you're having a laugh.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
That's like what he's known for.
And you were having a huge coma shit.
Right.
Are you having a huge. Oh, my God. I wanted you to laugh and I felt like I caused you pain.
No. But also, you know, I have no one to blame but myself. You know, we did. We put it all up there, you know.
Yeah.
There was no one putting a gun to my head, being like, make it not funny. I made it. Not funny. And also, I feel bad for saying this because I think Trevor would disagree with me on a lot of this. I think Trevor has a different opinion of it. But for me, it was, you know, did it feel not funny when we
when
were
you
making
were making it?
It
were you like,
you got to understand, when you're doing something on that scale for a studio like that, you have 30 people every day telling you how great it is.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying they were wrong. They were encouraging me. You know, they weren't saying, like, you're a genius, but, like, I was being encouraged. It was a very nurturing environment.
Yeah.
And, no, I think I realized we were in trouble when I saw the first editor's assembly.
That
I was
late?
Like, well, that's pretty – I mean, after – that was the first thing you see when you sit down after you come out of production.
Yeah.
They've been cutting it together while you're shooting on set every day, and then you sit down, like, 2 days later and look at it, and they've cut the whole movie together.
Wow.
And I was like, oh, we have.
Did – at that point, were you and Trevor disagreeing, or did he feel the
same
way?
He felt the same way, but then, you know, you work on it forever, and then you can't see the forest from the trees, and people are, again, telling you, like, oh, this is going to be great. And then when it comes out, you're thinking, is it going to be great?
Yeah.
I don't think so. Maybe.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Right.
And then it's – and you know, it's crazy when you have a movie come out, you know, like a wide release, you know, Friday night at midnight how well your movie's going to do.
Wow.
Because they can judge by those very few East Coast screenings. They can project pretty accurately
the country,
what you're looking at.
And you knew it was going to be.
And I remember I was in Austin, Texas. We were on tour and I got wasted the night before and I woke up really hungover and the email was waiting for me and I was so excited and I opened that email and I saw the numbers and it was just like the world just came crashing down in that moment.
Yeah.
It was really intense.
It's like Nick Swartzen put out that movie Bucky something.
Uh-huh. I'm sure he had a similar experience.
And I think he went on, I don't want to speak for Nick, I heard he went on a bender.
Sure, like, dude.
For a very long time.
I get it because you can't help but project what it's going to do if it works.
Yeah.
You can't help but think, you know, positively of like, you know, if this movie goes and it's like it's a success, you know, what is it's going to change
right,
my life.
Right.
You're living in this fantasy.
Right.
You know, unless you're like a good Zen dude and you're grounded, you know, I had no idea. You know, I think now I'd handle it a lot better.
Mm.
Like, but it was devastating.
Yeah.
For sure.
But you're still at it. I'm not trying to give this some trite button at the end.
No.
But
I'm
it's
totally
great
at it.
That you're still at it.
I have no backup plan.
Yeah, man.
You know? I don't respect people that do. that's not true. I give whatever.
No,
it's intelligent.
I think that was true. Let's go with a different part of the brain theory. There's part of your brain that feels that way. You know what I mean?
My whole brain feels like I don't have a backup plan.
Yeah, but your part of your brain feels like you have a little bit of a cruelty to be like, fuck it, let's do this. You're John McClane.
Yeah, I'm all in. I'm all in.
You're all in and you like other people that are all in.
I do.
Yeah. And that's why we enjoy each other.
You know, it bums me out. But don't you get – I bet you get this. Don't you have people that don't live in L.A. or New York that are like, what do I do? I'm like, move to L.A. or New York. Like,
right.
I don't know. Well, then I don't want to talk to you. Because if you're not going to go all out, like, why would I waste my time? Like,
I was just thinking about this today. I've ended friendships because I need to be around people that are like – have their shit together to a certain extent.
Yeah.
And are all in. Like,
yeah.
I need to be inspired by the people that are around me. And if you're the kind of person that, like, will, like, you know, be at a party and just casually take a handful of miscellaneous weird pills and stuff, and or whatever, you know, like, I can't be with people that are just, like, drugged up and off the path and just confused and and weird and stupid and not killing it. You can kind of, if you're killing it, you can kind of do whatever you want if that works for you. But I realized the way that I'm a bigot, maybe, is that I need to be around people that inspire me. Is that bigotry?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Although, you know, I am also friends with people and might not be killing it in ways we can, you know, quantify. Like, they're not on a show or writing for a show or doing, you know. But all I care is, like, are you working as hard as you can be working to this? And if you are, cool, you're in.
Yeah. I agree with that. That's I agree all. With that.
Yeah.
That's a good place to end. I bet Allison Rosen is downstairs freaking out. Oh, you did? Oh, thanks, Katie.
This has really been a pleasure.
You're a pleasure.
You're
I can't
a pleasure.
Believe how much we have in common.
I know. It's crazy, dude.
It's really weird. What?
And we live so close to each other.
I know.
We should be hanging out
let's
more
hang
often.
Out. Let's hang out more. I'd love to see how we talk if we're liquored up.
Oh, baby.
or well, yoga.
Come by
up.
My house at 1 in the morning.
I love non-racist skinheads.
Yeah, they're serious about their are sharp
they,
thing.
I like wish you, they were straight edge. That would be more fun.
That would be, I don't know if it would be more or less fun. But
probably be less fun.
Staunchly non-racist.
The show ends with the guest. Oh, I told you I'd do this. Steve Jobs, Gordon, Hawaii, pregnant is written and circled. Dumb. I don't remember what dumb was. Ensemble. I wanted to talk to you about working in ensemble. Who cares? Slap. There's your thing. Small school. Who cares? Music, art, fulfilled. Who cares? We did it. Would you end by, we asked the guest to say, keep it crispy. It just means, you know, live your life. Listen to some Sam Cooke on the way to work and roll down the windows in a park. That's keeping it crispy.
Okay.
Keep it crispy.
Yeah!
All right.
Love it.
Great.
Thank you, Zach.
Thank you.
Good to see you, man. So crispy. So crispy.